Super Tuesday, results pouring in by the minute. 7 polls close in this hour. We already have results in Virginia. Rob pointed that out, which Trump won handily. Vermont and North Carolina, which Trump also won. Trump is projected to win all 3 of the states. 6 states just closed 11 seconds ago. Maine, Massachusetts, which some say maybe Nikki Haley's best shot to have some sort of upside, Massachusetts. Alabama's closed. Tennessee closed. Texas is mostly closed. We'll get to that in a second. Oklahoma, and the results are pouring in. This is going to be a long night for Nikki Haley, folks. There's a very slim chance Nikki Haley will win any state. Think about that. 15 GOP states tonight. President Trump is expected to sweep all those 15 states. What does Nikki Haley do from here? How do you spin losing every race except D.C.? How do you even spin winning D.C., for that matter? Does she see herself having any viable path to the nomination? That's a no. It can't be about that. Does she see her purpose now as a spoiler? Or is she waiting in the wings for Trump to stumble on the politically driven indictments? Good question. These quick calls say Trump's popularity is at an all-time high. Remember, people are calling, we're calling races as the polls close. Think about that. Despite, or perhaps because of, what the Democrats are doing, the Democrats think that prosecuting and persecuting Trump can hurt his popularity. But voters have seen this. They've been through this partisan witch hunt. Trump is appealing to the American heartland, while the Democrats and Nikki Haley are pushing a woke agenda. That's why these races are being decided so quickly. Senior correspondent John Huddy is at Mar-a-Lago in the ballroom in Palm Beach, Florida, one I know very well. Huddy, what's the feeling there? Sounds like there's a lot of emotion.
Yeah, well, there is, and every time it comes on, the results are coming on the televisions here. You know, Aurora goes up, people start applauding and clapping. So momentum is building here. And look, the expectation is it's going to be a clean sweep, as you've been talking about. I've been scanning, Eric. I've been scanning the room, looking for one Trump surrogate. I could tell you this. Yesterday, I was here at Mar-a-Lago in what's called the living room for Trump's remarks about SCOTUS's Colorado ballot decision. And as I was leaving, Vivek Ramaswamy was coming in, and as you know, and as we've been reporting, Ramaswamy's been on the campaign trail. He's been one of the big supporters of former President Trump, along with Senator Tim Scott. So I've been seeing if any of the surrogates are showing up. I know Marjorie Taylor Greene was here earlier. Members of Trump's senior staff, including Jason Miller, who's waiting here to go on after I'm finished, and other members of senior advisors are here as well. So we're expecting former President Trump to give some remarks a little bit later. I heard possibly after the polls close on the West Coast. And one of the issues, and we heard this yesterday, Eric, when I was here at Mar-a-Lago, one of the big issues, and we're seeing it in the exit polls, on voters' minds is immigration. Last week, as you know, former President Trump was in Texas. He was in Eagle Pass at Shelby Park with Governor Abbott, who, by the way, once again posted on X his endorsement of former President Trump. And while he was there, he took a question from me. I asked him about Venezuela, the number, the bulk of Venezuelan illegal migrants coming here. It's something that former President Trump has really been drilling down, because as we've seen, not only on Super Tuesday tonight, but as we saw in New Hampshire, in Iowa, this is a major issue, along with, of course, the economy and foreign wars, the wars in Ukraine, the war in Israel as well. So presumably, former President Trump is going to talk about the immigration issue once again tonight, as we're waiting to see who else arrives here, Eric. But again, it's a big night. And as far as Nikki Haley's campaign, by the way, we received some information from her campaign earlier saying that the mood in Charleston, which is where she is, she's watching the returns and the votes with her staff, is quote-unquote jubilant. So that's essentially how her campaign is playing it right now. But I can tell you this, the expectation here tonight is a big victory once again. Back to you.
All right, thank you, John Huddy. Mar-a-Lago again in that ballroom, folks. So North Carolina, Tennessee, Oklahoma, Virginia, and Maine are called for Trump as the polls close, folks. Tom Basile has the breakdown of the numbers so far. Tom, take it away, my friend.
All right. Well, look, it's 8 o'clock. That means that the polls have closed in the following states: Texas, Oklahoma, Tennessee, Alabama, Maine, and Massachusetts. Let's take a look at a couple of these. First off, up here in the state of Maine. Now, remember, they tried to kick Trump off the ballot. So one of the things we're looking at in places like Maine and maybe in Colorado is, are you going to see a Trump bump because they tried to play a game there? You're going to see maybe potentially more enthusiasm than ordinarily you would see for Trump in both of those states today. Let's talk about Alabama, okay? And Alabama redistricting has now put two Republicans, Jerry Carl and Barry Moore, up against each other tonight in Alabama CD1. We're going to keep an eye on that. And also, will the state Supreme Court ruling on IVF impact turnout anyway? Then there is the state of Texas. This is the second biggest prize today, and there's a lot going on in the state of Texas, particularly the U.S. Senate race. Who's going to take on Ted Cruz, right? You've got Colin Allred, the former NFL linebacker, and you've got State Senator Roland Gutierrez. Both of these folks are going to be, they're going to be pitted against each other tonight. We're going to be following that. Take a look at these numbers on what is driving people to the polls today in the state of Texas. Not surprisingly, border security and immigration, well over 50%, and gun control. And Gutierrez has kind of made that a part of his campaign in the Senate primary, so that's why it's up there as well. Also, there are a number of other down-ballot races in Texas. There's an intra-party fight going on that involves dozens of members of the state legislature, and we're going to be following that to see if we're going to have a change in that state legislature, whether or not it'll be more conservative as we head off into November.
Got it. Tom, thank you. And I guess we're going to come back to you as things progress throughout
Absolutely.
The evening. Awesome. Well, here now to break down the latest results tonight as Trump looks to sweep all 15 states is senior advisor to Donald Trump. Jason Miller joins us from, I believe, Mar-a-Lago, if I'm not mistaken. There he is. Jason, I talked to HUD. He said it's an upbeat atmosphere. But he also said from the Haley camp, from their watch party, they're jubilant there. Do you believe that?
No. And in fact, Nikki Haley said that she's not going to be speaking this evening. That's usually not a good sign. But Eric, as you and I discussed recently, Nikki Haley is going to get wiped out by a delegate avalanche this evening. 15 states, much different than the state-by-state approach we've seen up to this point. President Trump will finish the night leading Nikki Haley by roughly 1,000 delegates, set President Trump up to capture the nomination just next Tuesday.
So what do you think, Jason, what's the, first of all, let me do this. Nikki Haley she's been all over television, and she's changing. Early on, she was a little nicer to Trump. She said, in order to get to that debate stage, she rose her hand saying, I swear whoever the Republican nominee is, I will support them. And now she seems to be backpedaling on that. And the attacks seem to be a little bit more vicious. Take a listen to Nikki Haley blaming Trump for the border and some of the other things, and also being friendly with Putin. Listen.
These are people who want to go and see a secure border, and they don't like the fact that Trump stopped Congress from trying to fix the bill and pass a strong border bill. This is about national security, where we should be preventing war, and Trump said he would stand with Putin as he invaded our allies.
Jason, that sounds more like a Democrat than a Republican to me.
Yeah, and Eric, I get it. When you go and run for president, when you put your name on the line, it's tough to lose like this over and over, which is what Nikki Haley is doing. So I want to extend a little bit of grace and understanding what her and her campaign are going through. But this is much bigger than Nikki Haley. This is about beating Joe Biden in the fall. And with President Trump having such a commanding lead, now is the time that we need to come together. You look at state after state. We've had Virginia and North Carolina called already so far this evening, 13 more to go. This is the time to send the message, hey, Joe, you're fired.
So, Jason, what's a win? It's highly expected Trump wins all 15. We were talking a little bit earlier that Vermont looks like it's tighter than a lot of people expected. It's a tiny state, not many delegates. But if Trump were to lose one of the 15 states, would that be some sort of loss for him? Or explain the mentality of right now, of tonight.
Well, actually, when you look at it compared to 2016, President Trump is doing twice as well when he only beat John Kasich by is roughly 2 points. So having a 4 or 4.5 point lead right this moment actually bodes better for President Trump. But when you see all the rest of these states, these are huge margins, whether it be Virginia, whether it be North Carolina. The only places where it might be a little bit tighter are places, for the most part, where you have open primaries, where we see Democrats invading the Republican primary, or you see see Democrat behaving voters invading the Republican primary, although that wasn't the case in Virginia, where it is an open primary, and President Trump is blowing it out right now.
You know, I watched some of the, the polling leading up to tonight, and California struck me because there are a lot of Democrats in California, and a lot of people would think that Nikki Haley would do well in a state like that. And going into California today, Trump was polling at 73% to Haley's 18% or so. How do you explain that?
Well, quite frankly, President Trump has put in the work. He's raised the money. He's able to maximize the connections from running in 2016 and 2020, having been president of the United States for 4 years. And Nikki Haley simply ran out of money and wasn't competitive in California or any of the other Super Tuesday states. In fact, Nikki Haley's campaign said that they were going to spend $1 million over the last 9 days over the 15 states. They ended up only being able to raise and spend about $350,000. So her campaign is out of gas. It's out of money. It's time for Nikki Haley to pack it up. At this point, the only person she's helping is Joe Biden.
What's her end game here, Jason? I mean, a lot of people would say, well, she's trying to set herself up for 2028, but the way she's flipping, she's becoming more, I don't know, aggressive towards Trump. That certainly doesn't bode well for her in 2028. Or are she, her donors, and maybe the establishment crowd that is backing her think that the voters and the MAGA crowd will forget what she's doing in 24 when she runs in 28? What's her end game here?
Yeah, that's a good question, because I can't figure it out as I try to look through it from a strategic or even some aspect of an analytical mind. It doesn't make sense what Nikki Haley is doing, because she's gone beyond just attacking President Trump into really attacking the entire Republican Party. But here's the message, Eric. The Republican Party is solidly united behind President Trump. That's why he's putting up win after win. I hear cheering in the background, so I'm guessing that's another state just being called for President Trump.
Yeah, it's going to be a hard night for the Nikki Haley crowd to be watching these returns. I noticed Oklahoma, we put that. Oklahoma was called with 0% in. And we're projecting right now that Trump won North Carolina, Tennessee, Oklahoma with 0% in when we called it, Virginia, Maine, and Alabama. What's next, Jason? I know you look to next week, because you have Georgia and a couple other states that literally could put him over the threshold, the 12-15 threshold. What's the message between now and then? Is he going to go to Georgia? Is he going to spend some time in Georgia?
Yeah, President Trump will be in Georgia this next Saturday. He'll have a rally at 5 o'clock Eastern, Rome, Georgia. And the general election has started. President Trump taking the fight to Joe Biden, just the exact same way that President Trump kicked off his campaign in 2022, looking ahead to 2024 here. We're taking the fight to Joe Biden. As we saw those images of both presidents down at the border this last week, Joe Biden can't walk, he can't talk. Even late night comedy has abandoned Joe Biden, and they're just piling on. People want to change, they want to turn around the inflation, they want to secure the southern border. That starts now.
What about the money, Jason? You say Nikki Haley's out of money, out of luck, out of time, out of money. Where's Trump's money coming from, and are these wins creating more your donor base to expand?
Yeah, we had our best small dollar fundraising month ever in February, so really good month. We're going to continue that success going. The money's coming in. And also keep in mind, with President Trump now putting some new allies in charge at the RNC, that vote's coming up in Houston on Friday. The RNC is going to be in a much better position in 2024 than we've ever seen it. I think fundraising is going to come back up really quick with the RNC. In fact, January was their best month that they've had in quite some time. The money is going to come for President Trump. We have the right ideas. We have the money. But most importantly, we have the right candidate. We have the person who's going to win.
Very quickly, we're hearing about this massive war chest that Biden is creating. Who's spending so much money to make sure Joe Biden gets reelected?
Well, of course, it's the radical liberals. But here's the thing, Eric. It doesn't matter how much are in his campaign coffers. You can't buy youth, you can't buy vigor, and you can't buy a good record. Joe Biden's going to be held accountable for his terrible record, and voters have had enough of someone who's doddering and cognitively declined.
All right, Jason, we're going to let you get back to the party, the celebration. And, folks, Donald Trump will, allegedly, Jason tells us he will come and make give us a few minutes of his thoughts later on in the evening, so you got to stick around. All right, folks, thank you, Jason, by the way. Coming up, Nikki Haley managed to win the swamp, D.C., by the same margin that she lost her home state to Donald Trump. and she's losing big again tonight. We'll explain what this means for her failed presidential race next.
Special coverage of Super Tuesday is sponsored by Preserve Gold. Text SUPER to 50505 to get up to $15,000 in free gold and silver.
All right, folks, huge night for President Trump. Newsmax now projecting Trump won North Carolina, Tennessee, Oklahoma, Virginia, Maine, and Alabama. Nikki Haley's misleading victory in the swamp of D.C. should tell you everything you need to know about her candidacy, where it lies here on March 5th. Folks, she's not what she says she is. She may have the elites on the hook, maybe some Democrats on the hook, but actual real Republicans, conservatives, see right through her messaging. She has already proven that she can't be trusted and recently showed her true colors on NBC, of all places. I think we have that sound.
You did sign a pledge, an RNC pledge, yeah, to support the eventual nominee. Do you still feel bound by that pledge?
I have always said that I have serious concerns about Donald Trump. I have even more concerns about Joe Biden.
So is that a no? Are you bound by the RNC pledge?
The RNC pledge, I mean, at the time of the debate, we had to take it to where would you support the nominee? And you had to, in order to get on that debate stage, you said yes. The RNC is now not the same RNC. Now it's
so you're no Trump's longer bound by that pledge?
No, I think I'll make what decision I want to make, but that's not something I'm thinking about.
Well, that's an interesting answer. It's time to throw all of our weight behind one candidate, folks. Nikki Haley, whether you like it or not, the time is not now for her. Political analyst Mark Halperin and senior fellow at American Conservative Union, Mercedes Schlapp, both join me now. Mercedes, my problem with that soundbite is that in order to make that debate stage, she had to swear by that pledge. Take the oath that I will support the eventual nominee just to get on the stage. She did it.
Right.
And she's backtracking. I mean, isn't this what we don't want in politicians?
It's more that she's spinning her way out of answering the question. And you have to admit, I mean, Trump wasn't even on the debate stage. I'm not sure who's giving her that advice. She can't keep isolating these MAGA voters, which obviously she's just honing in on courting independents or disgruntled Republicans or never Trumpers. That is not going to be enough to form a coalition. She's got to step out. It is time for her to drop out of this race. She has nowhere to go. And the more she continues this battle against Donald Trump, it's going to put her in a position where she won't even be able to run in 2028, for crying out loud, because she's defined herself as being pretty much anti-Trump and anti-MAGA.
So, Mark, there is another option. There's the No Labels Party who believes they'll be on all 50 ballots. Not sure they will. They think they will. Is this part of her plan?
Well, she's not been very specific about anything, and she's engaged in a lot of non-denial denials. I thought maybe she thought behaving by staying in the race, she could get the second most delegates and be the alternative if Donald Trump for some reason couldn't be the nominee. I think that's out the window because the people who would pick that are either the RNC delegates or the RNC itself. I don't think they're favorably disposed towards her. 2028 viability, I don't see it after this because it's still going to be Donald Trump's party, win or lose. Running as an independent, running as No Labels, she's not taking it off the table really, but where's her constituency?
So what does that do? And, Mercy, you bring in the No Labels, potentially Nikki Haley,
right.
You have RFK Jr. also. Where are these votes, where are they siphoned from?
Well, first of all, I think she really tried to hedge her bets on if Donald Trump gets convicted then, or it puts be put in jail, then she could be that alternative. I think, Mark, to your point, I think the Republican Party's quickly rejecting her. So I think for the independent voters, what you're starting to see is that it's becoming the two-man race between Trump and Biden. Biden's coalition is falling apart very quickly as of now. The women, Hispanics, they're moving towards Donald Trump. Even independents are moving towards Donald Trump. I mean, this is a big phenomenon. When you're talking about the New York Times poll, Trump is up by 5%. Mm-hmm. He's in a good position, and I believe that the polls for the Democrats, they've got to be nervous because Biden is really struggling to keep his base enthusiastic, while Donald Trump's base is highly enthusiastic as
the base. But also, Mark, Trump is polling 23-25% with blacks. That's a loss, right?
I laugh when Democrats say only people who support Donald Trump is the MAGA base. Do the math, people. He's ahead. It's not just the MAGA
right.
base. Donald Trump operates on the premise, as does Chris LaCivita, who he works with, what's mine is mine and what's yours we'll negotiate over. Trump is keeping his base and moving towards the center on immigration, on inflation, on a bunch of issues. Joe Biden is in a quandary now because on issues like Israel and immigration, he can't afford to alienate his base. If he does, his approval rating will go down to the mid-30s. He has to somehow shore up the base and go to the center. If you're Bill Clinton or Barack Obama or George Bush, you have or Donald Trump, you've got the political skills to do that.
Got to leave it there because the Democrats are they're caught in between a rock and a hard place right now with both things, the border and also funding funding Gaza
and
funding
inflation.
In the war.
And the economy, yes.
All of them. It's Trump's time. Mercedes, thank you. Mark, thank you both very much. Okay, folks, what are we doing here? All right, Super Tuesday, election results keep pouring in. We're going to break it all down. The latest results coming in. Guess what? Carrie Lake will be here to weigh in on that very important Arizona Senate race. Kyrsten Sinema, I'm sorry, will not run for re-election. What does that mean for that Senate seat? It could be the balance of power in the Senate. Don't go anywhere. That's all coming up next. We are following a massive night for former President Donald Trump. Newsmax is now projecting another major victory for Mark Robinson in North Carolina. Remember, Mark Robinson is running for governor of North Carolina, one of very, very important governorships that are up for grabs in this election cycle. I believe 11 of them. That one will be very important. Remember, North Carolina elects a lot of Democrat governors. They elect a lot of Republican presidents, but they somehow vote for Democrats. So Mark Robinson, a very strong candidate. And remember, Donald Trump supported him handily, strongly in the lead up to this primary. Tom Basile has the breakdown of some of the numbers. Tom, we have you back. A lot more going on.
Yeah, and I want to show you something here in the state of North Carolina. Let's take a look at the Republican numbers right now. You see Donald Trump up 73.5 to 23, 20% of the votes in. But take a look at the Democrat side and look who's in number the second spot here. No preference. And one of the things to keep in mind is that no preference or uncommitted. There are 9 of the states that we're going to be talking about tonight allow you to vote that way. This number has ticked up over the course of the last hour. We're going to be keeping an eye on this and whether or not this drops Joe Biden below 90% in a number of these states, because that is going to be significant. That is what shows you in places perhaps like Maine or Minnesota or Vermont or some of these others where he may be really feeling a backlash either from his far left or just general dissatisfaction with the way that that he's handling his presidency and his ability to carry the Democrat banner ahead into the future. Let's take a look at the Republican side in the state of Tennessee. No surprise there. Only 3% of the vote in, but Donald Trump way ahead. And in the state of Texas, some new numbers there, 71 to 23, 6% of the votes in, and we are going to be continuing to drill down into these all night long here.
All right, Tom, thank you, and we will stay with you throughout the night because these things are coming fast and furious, and Trump winning a lot of races. All right, well, will Republicans be able to flip Arizona in the next presidential election? And also, will they be able to take back a Senate seat? Those chances just improved. Independent Senator Kyrsten Sinema, who won as a Democrat in 2018, then she flipped to independent, but she won as a Democrat in 2018, became the first non-Republican to win an Arizona Senate seat since 1994. But she just announced that she will not seek re-election. Her exit clears the way for Republican Carrie Lake and progressive challenger Representative Ruben Gallego. This race could very well determine the balance of power in the Senate. The stakes couldn't be higher. And we're fortunate to have Carrie Lake joining us right now, Arizona Senate candidate. Well, I congratulate you. And when I heard Sinema dropped out, Carrie, I'll be honest with you, full disclosure, folks, I texted Carrie and said, come on, let's talk about this today. I was watching, Carrie, the left, the liberals at CNN and MSNBC saying, oh, this is really great for Gallego. I disagree. In a state like Arizona, we have a Republican, Carrie Lake, and one Democrat, Gallego. The border becomes so much more important. Tell us why you think this is great for you.
Thank you for having me on tonight, Eric. It is good for us because we saw that when Kyrsten Sinema made 2 or 3 courageous votes to save the filibuster, the left and the Democrats turned on her like a pack of wild dogs. Mm-hmm. And that's when Ruben Gallego came in and said, we're going to take her down. And the Democrat Party turned on her for doing something that was right. Now, listen, I disagree with Kyrsten Sinema on almost every policy, but I applaud her for her courage to stand up for the filibuster. And we're looking at polling, and we've had many polls that have been done for the entirety of this year, and it showed that she was taking a few more Republican votes than Democrats, because the Democrats have gone so full tilt to the left. They're not even Democrats of yesteryear. They are full-on, frankly, Marxist radicals. And so we're happy that Senator Sinema is now realizing that she doesn't have a path to victory. We're wishing her the best. We thank her for those courageous votes. And now we are dead set on stopping the communist push of America Democrats to basically destroy our country. Ruben Gallego is for open borders. He says border walls are stupid. He wants everybody pouring across the border to have voting rights to vote in this next election. He's against the Iron Dome. He has supported funding these terrorist cells in the Middle East, which are just a phone call away from sparking terrorist cells from activating in America when he supported the Iran deal. And frankly, he was for military members being kicked out of the military because they had a few questions about that vaccine that they weren't comfortable with, and he wants to replace them with illegals who have poured over our border. He's wrong for America. He's wrong for Arizona. He makes people like AOC and Mark Kelly look like mainstream moderates, and he's dangerous for America.
You know, and you point out very accurately that Kyrsten Sinema was, she was a Democrat, I'm sorry, in 2018 when she was elected. She abandoned the Democrat Party, so to speak. She became more of a centrist, and the Democrats never forgave her for that. So those who say that she was going to take more votes away from Gallego, I don't believe that. I think she may have taken centrist, middle-of-the-road Republicans away from you. This is opening the door. The number one issue across all of these voters, these exit polling, is immigration, and that lands in a Republican's lap, does it not?
It truly does, and we know already that Ruben Gallego is open borders. He's for giving everybody walking across the border. We've all seen the images. These are fighting-age men. He wants every one of them to receive asylum and citizenship and voting rights. And frankly, you know, I disagree with Kyrsten Sinema on her policy. This border, you know, bill that she was part of the architect of was a disaster. It wasn't about securing the border. It was about sending $95 billion overseas to kill people. It was not about securing the border. We know that the folks of Arizona, the people in Arizona want border security. They want a strong economy. Everything they are for, Ruben Gallego is against. He actually was pushing and voting against Medicare, wanted to take $800 million from Medicare to basically cripple people who have done everything right, paid into the system, and now they're retired, because he wanted to send a whole bunch of money over to Ukraine and rob the people who've worked hard their entire life. They've earned that benefit. They've worked hard, and he wants to send that money over to Ukraine. Any penny he can send to Ukraine, he's for. Any penny he can send to the border wall, he's against. Any penny he can send to support senior citizens, he's against. This is going to be a very clear race between what is America first and America last. And I think the people of Arizona will get this right.
Folks, circle that Arizona Senate race, because the Senate, again, is down to one. If you flip that seat, because it was an independent, it wasn't a Republican, you get a Kerry Lake in there, you get a Republican in there, you just might hold the Senate chamber. Kerry, got to go. Thank you.
Real quick, the road to the White House for President Donald J. Trump and the road to the Senate majority goes right through Arizona. We win Arizona or we lose it all. We need everybody to get on board. KerryLake.com. This is a critical race. I am going to be in the Washington, D.C., and I'm going to represent the people of Arizona and the people of this country. We need folks like Donald Trump who are fighters. I will fight for the people of Arizona.
Well, congratulations on the, maybe the new wide open path. Kerry, great to have you on. Appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric.
All right, folks, a big projection here. Another Donald Trump victory, Arkansas. There you go. We're calling it for Donald Trump, Arkansas. All right, joining us now from Mar-a-Lago is former Florida Attorney General Pam Bondi. Pam, you're there. Arkansas, that's a nice win for Donald Trump right there, inching closer and closer and closer to that 12-15. Yeah. Can't happen tonight, but he can certainly set himself up to happen on March 12th or 19th.
Yeah, it can't happen tonight, but it will happen, absolutely. And Eric, I can't believe you're not here tonight. This crowd is crazy, and everyone is so excited. This is a big, big night for our country.
So what in your, you know, you spend a lot of time there, you're behind the scenes. You know, I mean, Trump, is Nikki Haley getting inside Trump's head at all? I mean, he calls her bird brain, and he's got the names for her, but this really is Trump versus Biden. He's focused on Biden. He's on the general election path already, isn't he?
Yeah. Eric, Nikki Haley is completely irrelevant. She's funded by Democrats, in my opinion. She is a Democrat now. She has zero path to victory. President Trump is 100% focused on Joe Biden, as should every American be. I mean, this is about saving our country, protecting our border, fixing our economy, everything that Donald Trump did his first term and will do again. So, no, he is focused on Joe Biden, and it's time for all Republicans to come together, if you're a real Republican, and support Donald Trump.
You know, and so, Pam, we'll ask you about this, you being an attorney, former Attorney General of Florida. The Supreme Court struck down Colorado, the Supreme Court, and said, no way, a state cannot decide a presidential election. That has to happen from the federal level. Huge win for Trump. Do you think some of these other states that are up to 13 that were thinking about pulling Trump from the ballot, does all that go away now?
Yeah, it does, Eric. And, you know, it was a unanimous decision, and that's very, very important. And I think that speaks volumes that even some liberal judges on the court believe that it should be left up to the people of America, not one or two bad secretaries of state in certain states. No, this should be left up to the people of America, and it will be decisively in November.
Very quickly, Pam, about half a minute or so, Dick Durbin, the senator from Illinois, was upset that the Supreme Court will take up the Trump immunity argument. Give us a quick assessment of that.
Yeah, they absolutely should have taken it up. They did. It took five justices to do it, and it will take five to say that he had presidential immunity. If Donald Trump does not have presidential immunity, it's a danger for every Democrat, for every Republican, future president in this country. You must have presidential immunity, or you can't function as an American president.
Yeah, you tie a president's hands not knowing what he can and can't do going forward.
Absolutely.
Pam Bondi, really good having you from Mar-a-Lago, the ballroom there. Thank you, Pam.
Thanks,
Eric. All right, folks, instead of deporting illegals, a bombshell report reveals the Biden administration flew hundreds of thousands of illegals into the country to help them circumvent the Border Patrol. Wow, amazing, amazing. Well, we're going to talk about that in just a minute, along with some new election results next.
Special coverage of Super Tuesday is sponsored by Preserve Gold. Text SUPER to 50505 to get up to $15,000 in free gold and silver.
Newsmax is closely following a major night for former President Donald Trump. One state that we're keeping an eye on, Vermont, where Trump and Haley were neck and neck. But I believe we've just called it for Donald Trump, is what they're telling me in my ear. Hopefully so. Joe Biden is failing America and putting our lives at risk with an already porous border and a sky-high record of illegal migrant encounters. The Biden administration has recently admitted to secretly arranging flights for over 320,000 illegal migrants from foreign airports directly to U.S. cities. Biden tried covering his tracks after being the catalyst of this mess since taking office in January 2021. And what's worse is he's aiding and abetting an invasion into our own country. Recent polling shows a sharp increase in people saying immigration is a very serious problem. Welcome to Joe Biden's America, folks. Here to react is Florida Congressman Greg Stube. Greg, good to have Congressman Greg. Good to have you on, my friend. That number, I was blown away. 320,000 people. And what they did is they flew them over the border so that wasn't counted as an encounter. Your thoughts? Were you as outraged as I am?
Yeah, all those people should go to prison for trafficking illegals into our country. Think of, like, the sex trafficking that could be going on, the drug trafficking that could be going on. And this administration is organizing all of this. It's absolutely abhorrent that you have administration officials who are doing this type of activity to evade our own administration and bring illegals into our country on top of the, you know, 10 million, 11 million, whatever number you're looking at today that have come into our country. We have a crime crisis in our country. We have a border crisis in our country, and we have a fentanyl crisis in our country, and every single one of those have been caused by Joe Biden's open border policies.
Can you imagine, though, 320,000 people, Congressman, illegals that they flew in? What message are you sending the rest of the world? It's wide open. Come on in. We'll take you. We even fly you here into our major cities.
Yeah, I mean, that's the size of some counties in my district. It's more than the size of some counties in my district. So think of the inside, more than people in Charlotte County, Florida, coming in from Biden administrations flying these individuals in to evade our border patrol. I wonder how many terrorists were on those flights. I wonder how many rapists and murderers were on those flights, drug dealers, sex traffickers. Those will be all very great questions that the Republican majority will have for Mayorkas the next time we talk to him.
Yeah. Elon Musk, he bashed Biden on his platform X after his administration admitted to importing hundreds of thousands of migrants into the country. Musk tweeted this or X'd this. He said, quoting, "The administration is both importing voters and creating a national security threat from unvetted illegal immigrants. It's highly probable that the groundwork is being laid for something far worse than 9/11. Just a matter of time." Now, this isn't some right wing. This isn't Alex Jones or some right winger. Elon right. Musk is saying this.
Yeah, and he's absolutely right. If you drill down on some of the numbers and some of the countries of origins of some of these individuals, you've got over 40,000 Chinese Communist Party individuals, mostly military-age males. You have over 30,000 Russians. You have over 6,000 Afghans. You have Iranians. You have people from the Middle East. You have people from countries that hate us and talk about destroying America that they are bringing into this country. And it's absolutely I mean, there's no words for the frustration I have as a military guy. We should be about the safety and security of the American people. And it's like they hate our country so much that they're going to allow this to happen at the southern border, allow terrorists to come into our country. And we're all just supposed to sit back and let them do it for their political objectives.
Congressman, thank you for your service. Thank you for our freedom. And thank you for standing up for the good people of Florida. Appreciate that. Congressman Greg Stube, thank you.
Anytime.
All right, folks, Super Tuesday election results keep coming in. We're going to break down the latest with the panel next. Americans are making their voices heard in a big way today, in a very big way. As expected, this was a huge day for Donald Trump. Newsmax now projecting victories in, ready, North Carolina, Tennessee, Oklahoma, Virginia, Maine, Alabama, Arkansas, and in Vermont. The race is getting close there, neck and neck, they're telling me. Newsmax is keeping a close eye on all the races throughout the night. Senior fellow with the American Conservative Union, Mercedes Schlapp, is back with us now, along with the host of American Agenda, Bob Brooks. I'll start with you, Bob. I haven't spoken to you yet, and we're going to hear a lot of Mercedes tonight. Victory, clear. Yeah. Mm-hmm. If he somehow doesn't win Vermont, is that going to put a damper on the whole evening?
No, I don't think it does. And unless something insane happens, I think tonight we're seeing that former President Trump is going to be the GOP again. And I think one of the talking points that we've heard while the campaign battle is going on between his opponent, Nikki Haley, that, you know, former President Trump surrounded by chaos all the time. My big thing with that is a lot of that chaos fabricated by the left.
Right.
Fabricated by his political opponents, the impeachments, Robert Mueller investigations, the indictments here. If you look at his record, though, as president, after all that, you push it aside. What a record that was. And tonight you're seeing Americans come back out and say, hey, we like that. We liked it a lot.
So, Mercy, it's common political theory that when you run for president during the primary season, you know, you become a little bit more fringy. Right. Mm-hmm. And then when you go towards the general, you move to the center. Is it time for Trump to move to the center a little with policy?
I actually think Trump has been very true to Trump and his policies. People know what they're going to get with Donald Trump. It's an America first policies. He has been very clear on how he defines it. we are going to shut down that border. We got to stop this chaos that we're seeing with illegal aliens crossing the border, committing crimes within the United States, killing innocent Americans, as we saw with the case with Lake and Riley and her tragic death. And then obviously people are still feeling the effects of the Biden inflation. It's not Bidenomics, it's Bidenflation. And that you're talking about high food prices. People can't buy their homes.
Can I just tell you, you hear rents. What Biden did today? Did you hear what he did on Twitter or X or whatever on social media?
I'm trying to think because he's
the
so
Cookie
ineventful.
Monster. He's
no
talking.
No
he had
way.
A conversation with yes. the
no
Cookie
way.
Monster about shrinkflation.
Don't tell me Cookie Monster is now a Democrat. That's really good. Yes.
Well, it's NPR.
How
is
can
NPR?
Cookie Monster it's, afford all those cookies?
He wants bigger cookies.
With those you,
exactly. The shrinkflation
wait,
cookies.
The shrinkflation. Yes. Is that what it is?
That's what it is.
I mean, who's like who's yeah. running Let me, the show?
I'll tell you who. I'll tell you who's running the show. All the comms people. Instead of like you really want to use Cookie Monster when yeah. people are struggling
right.
with their wallets and their inflation, guys, they're telling me I got to wrap. We have a bunch of stuff to get to. Bob Brooks, Mercedes Schlapp, thank you both for joining us, and we'll see both of you later on this evening.
Yes.
All right, folks, coming up, we'll have much more on the Super Tuesday results. They're falling for Trump left and right. More balance after this. Well, as we've been saying, Americans are making their voices heard tonight in a very big way. As expected, this was a huge day for President Donald Trump. Newsmax is now projecting victories in North Carolina. And don't forget, also, Lieutenant Governor Mark Robinson is locked down that primary there, so he will be the Republican primary challenger for that governorship in North Carolina. Tennessee, Oklahoma, Virginia, Maine, Alabama, Arkansas, the list goes on and on. In Vermont, the race is neck and neck, and we will keep a very close eye on all those races through the night. That's all the time we have. Thank you for joining me tonight during this Super Tuesday coverage. We're continuing our live coverage, special coverage all night long, Super Tuesday. Up next, Greg Kelly and Jen Pellegrino are going to take over the coverage and stay with Newsmax all night. This is going to go all the way to midnight, folks, when California finally closes. Have a great night. We'll see you back here again tomorrow. But tonight, big night for President Donald Trump. Good evening.
Special coverage of Super Tuesday is sponsored by Preserve Gold. Text SUPER to 50505 to get up to $15,000 in free gold and silver.
Hello, everybody. The show, Greg Kelly Reports, is a lot different tonight because it is Super Tuesday, and it's turning into an amazing Tuesday, really, for Donald Trump. One of the ultimate political comebacks, I think, in the history of the planet. Jen Pellegrino, great to have you here.
Great to be with you, Greg. Always a pleasure.
So what do you think? So far, Eric just listed all the states that Donald Trump has more or less clinched. We got, what, a half dozen or so to go, and it's looking very, very good, of course.
No surprises, right? I think what we all expected.
I don't think there are much in the way of surprises. However, Tom Basile joins us, and Tom, nobody has his finger on Republican politics like Tom Basile. Tom, are you surprised by anything?
No, and this is a huge night for Donald Trump, and the polls have just closed in Colorado and in Minnesota, but I want to show you something in the state of Vermont, if we can, over here, folks. The state of Vermont right now, if Nikki Haley, and there's been a lot of talk about whether or not she's going to be able to bring up, to get any delegates here, and if she's going to, the state of Vermont is going to be her opportunity here. As we just mentioned, state of Minnesota, state of Colorado have now closed, but Vermont is neck and neck. We're going to be drilling down county by county on that to see if we can actually call that race. But I want to talk about, here we go, there we go. And you can see, look at that, less than 1,000 votes between the two of them. We're going to be following as Burlington, as Rutland, as some of the population centers start to come in to see if Trump can hold on to that lead. But I want to talk for a second about Minnesota. And we're looking at Minnesota and Colorado here in this hour for a couple of different reasons. Minnesota is the home state of Dean Phillips. So if he has an opportunity to make any kind of a dent tonight at all into Joe Biden, it's going to be in his home turf. He's another one who, after tonight, may not have much of a campaign left. And there's a large Muslim population in the state of Minnesota. So are we going to see the kind of protest vote or uncommitted vote against Joe Biden that we saw in the state of Michigan? And then in Colorado, are we going to see a Trump bump in the state of Colorado? Because remember, Colorado, they tried to throw him off the ballot. And of course, a lot of issues here surrounding the economy and, of course, immigration really driving voter intent, even in a blue state. So we're going to be following it all hours, and we're going to be right through midnight tonight with all these races for you.
All right, Tom Basile, thank you.
All right, we're going to go to Mar-a-Lago right now. You've been very recently, I understand.
I have, yeah.
Well, Mar-a-Lago right on the beach there in Palm Beach, and John Huddy is standing by. That's where the president is tonight as well. We're expecting to hear from him. How soon, John, and what's it like down there? Good to see you, by the way.
Oh, it's very loud. It's good to see you guys, Greg and Jen. Yeah, it's very loud here, and every time totals come in from another state that Trump won, basically a roar comes up over the crowd, and I've been really kind of looking out over the crowd tonight, looking for surrogates, Trump surrogates coming in here. Senior advisors, Jason Miller was on the show a little bit earlier. Chris LaCivita was here. Also, senior members of his campaign staff, and I'm also looking for some of the other surrogates. You know, Tim Scott, who's been on the campaign trail with former President Trump. Also, Vivek Ramaswamy. One point yesterday, I was here at Mar-a-Lago in what's called the living room at the Mar-a-Lago Club, where former President Trump was giving remarks about SCOTUS's Colorado ballot decision. And as I was leaving, Vivek Ramaswamy was coming in. He's been on the campaign trail a lot, so I've been kind of looking for these surrogates. And one of the things that he talked about, along with not only SCOTUS's decision, but in his remarks yesterday, and we're waiting to see, and presumably he's going to talk about the same, is immigration. As we've been seeing, Greg and Jen, some of the exit polls are showing immigration is really a main topic that people are concerned about here tonight on Super Tuesday. And also that was the case in South Carolina, in New Hampshire, and Iowa as well, along with some of the other issues, the economy, inflation, foreign wars, the war in Ukraine, war in Israel. So we're waiting for former President Trump to come out. I've been told by the campaign, expect him more than likely to come out and give remarks after the polls close in California. Meantime, we got word from Nikki Haley's camp. She's in Charleston. She's watching the totals. She's watching the returns with her campaign staff, who says that the mood there is jubilant. But I can tell you this, the mood here, they're expecting a big victory tonight, and that's essentially what we're seeing at this point, Greg and Jen.
After California, you said, John, so that's, I see, that's 11 o'clock East Coast time, and he's not expected until then, huh?
Possibly, I was hearing maybe closer to around 10 o'clock, but that remains to be seen. Look, there's a lot of energy, a lot more people are coming in the room, so I think the music is a good indicator as well. We start hearing certain songs on the playlist. You know, we're getting close.
Well, you can feel the energy there at Mar-a-Lago. You know, you're coming across great, but you can hear the crowd back there. A lot of excitement. A great night as expected so far for Donald Trump. John Huddy, thank you so much.
We'll see you later. All right. We have the former attorney general with us, Matt Whitaker, excuse me, sir, and also Matt Schlapp with CPAC. Good to see you guys. First to you, Mr. Attorney General. What are you thinking? What are you seeing? Yeah.
Well, what I'm seeing kind of confirms what I have been seeing as I've traveled this country, whether it's in North Carolina, Virginia, or Texas. You know, there's just tremendous support for Donald Trump, and you're seeing that play out in all of these states. I think that this is the knockout blow. Obviously, Nikki has no path forward, and I would expect that she will endorse President Trump and be part of the team that helps him win in November, because it's going to take everybody to beat Joe Biden and the Democrats.
So a little bit of news. We can now project Newsmax projecting that Trump has won the state of Texas, the Lone Star State. Again, Matt, he was just down there a couple of days ago at the border, dueling visits between him and President Biden. Your thoughts on how this plays out? And again, this is Nikki Haley's last shot. We understand from Tom Baccile things are looking a little bit close in a state like Vermont. But how do you think this plays out in the coming days here? Is this the end of the road for her? Will there be an announcement tonight?
Yes, it's the end of the road for her. I mean, she's basically been on the side of the road with four flat tires for quite a long time. But I think the other people just want to make it seem like she's making progress. It's actually, can I say, it's kind of sad to watch. You know, yes, she can fill a small arena, or I mean a small room, and give a fiery speech, but it's a lot of finger wagging. Have you noticed this? It's a lot of like preaching towards people that we should be better than Donald Trump, when most of us feel like Donald Trump needs us to be better for him because he's taking on so much to save this country. But I will say, Jen, as someone who's been involved in politics for a really long time, I've lived old enough to comb white hair. I want to look at these numbers for Joe Biden, because I think what you're going to see across these states tonight is the Democrats just have no enthusiasm for their guy. We see this play out. They know that he's too old. They know that he's not up to it. And they're just not excited about him. They actually weren't excited about him last time, which is why we're all still scratching our head over the election in 2020. And I think what you're going to see is the opposite with Donald Trump, is big people, big numbers of people voting, Republicans very fired up to get the White House back, because they can see how scary it is when you put a woke socialist who's half gone in the head in charge of your country. It is a scary and frightening thing.
Hey, I saw Nikki Haley today on TV. It was, I don't know if I'd use the word sad, it was a little bit scary. There's something in her eyes, Matt, that she wants this so badly. Who's advising her? How can you stay in when the race is shaping up like this? I hear she's still getting a lot of money. Is that the key here?
Yeah, well, money's the lifeblood of politics. And obviously, when the money runs out, then the campaign runs out. But in this case, she's being funded by, you know, never Trumpers and Democrats. And I think that's a problem, right? When you have people interfering with a Republican primary and trying to, you know, make President Trump somehow, you know, not be the obvious and inevitable nominee. I think, you know, for the good of her country, but especially if she's a Republican, the time is now. I mean, beyond today or tonight, I just think there's really, you have to question of whether she's even a Republican.
Matt. I agree with Matt. Look, I agree with Matt on this real quick. I mean, she's destroying her ability to have a voice and a real role in the Republican Party going forward, as she's on this quixotic campaign that's going nowhere. She'd be so much smarter to get out now, endorse Donald Trump, and see if time can heal wounds.
So let me ask you this. Donald Trump is really starting to move on in his messaging. We're seeing more attacks on Biden than on Nikki Haley now. So the question now kind of being, so is Trump going to pick a running mate? Obviously, that might be sooner than we expect. Who do you think that might be?
Yeah, maybe I'll go first, Matt. You might have more information. But my choice, and I don't get to pick, and Donald Trump is going to make this pick, my choice would be for him not to pick a successor. I think that is going to get us into a lot of jealousy and competition in this important second term. I want him to pick somebody that on day one is not worried about their personal ego and ambition, but instead is going to help drain this swamp and implement this agenda. I'd like to see him pick somebody who actually wouldn't consider running for president, maybe is of an age where that's not going to happen. That would be my choice. That's why I love Ben Carson, for instance.
Interesting.
I think someone like Ben Carson would be fabulous.
And Greg Abbott has been a name that's come up in recent days as well, with all the attention at the border. Matt Whitaker, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think Matt Schlapp has some really good points, and I share the desire to have someone that's not immediately running for president and possibly undermining President Trump. Ben Carson is a great friend of mine. He'd do a fantastic job. You know, the great news for Republicans is there is a very deep bench. You know, you look, whether it's senators, whether it's governors, you look across this country, there are tremendous Republican leaders that could easily be vice president and, you know, assume the role if necessary. So I just think President Trump's probably got a really tough decision because there's so many great candidates.
All right, gentlemen, and some more news tonight. Not only has Trump won Texas, but Newsmax can also now project that Donald Trump has won the state of Colorado. And Greg, I got to think a lot of heads in Colorado are exploding tonight after they wanted to take him off the ballot there.
Oh, yeah, that's right. This was the state where it happened. So I love it. I absolutely love it. All right, well, Match Lab, Matt Whitaker, thank you. Let's see. Who do we think? Who do you think? A name for vice president.
Oh, man. Greg Abbott, I think, could be good. Byron Donalds has been another name that's really cropped up a lot. But Trump would have to, somebody would have to switch their home state in order for that to work.
Oh, yeah, they're both from Florida.
Right.
Oh, there goes that idea.
Yeah.
All right.
A lot of great options, though.
Super Tuesday is a super night for Donald Trump. We're looking live at Mar-a-Lago right now. Stay with us for a complete... Hey, a live look again at Mar-a-Lago. There is a lot of electricity in that room, Jen.
There is, yeah. We heard from John Huddy just a short while ago. Trump will be taking the stage in a little bit. We don't know an exact time, but... looking forward to his remarks. And
it's interesting, that is that room, it's very ornate and you got a big chandelier, mm-hmm. but it's just a few feet from the beach. The interior isn't very beachy, and that's the thing down there. No, with those big mansions,
right.
it's like they could be in England or something like that.
Yeah.
But
it's very fancy.
At the same time, beachy.
It's worth at least $18 million, don't you think?
Oh, yeah.
That ballroom alone.
Yeah, that was crazy. That silly case, that crazy judge. All right, we got to go to Texas where Donald Trump just won, and Mike Carter is standing by in the capital of Austin. Hi, Mike.
Hey, guys. Good evening. Well, this was, to say the least, expected from Donald Trump today. Most polls show Donald Trump up anywhere between 50 to 70 points coming into Super Tuesday. Right now, it looks like Trump is going to win by at least 50 points over Nikki Haley. Let's show you what Trump will win here in the state of Texas tonight. Texas, of course, one of the biggest electoral prizes on Super Tuesday. 150 delegates will go to Trump today. State officials will assign another 11 delegates at a statewide convention in May. Most, if not all, will also go to Donald Trump. Only in Texas and California today, guys, have Senate primaries taken place. And keep in mind, Republicans, they need to pick up one or two seats in the fall, depending on who wins the White House, to win a majority in the Senate. The race to earn a one-on-one matchup with Senator Ted Cruz, who's also on the ballot today, expected to win easily, the Democrat matchup has essentially come down to two contenders. Representative Colin Allred, a former NFL linebacker from North Dallas, he appears to be beating and will win against Texas State Senator Roland Gutierrez from San Antonio. It should be noted, however, no Democrat has won a statewide election here in Texas in decades. Well, speaking of Texas senators, Texas senior Republican Senator John Cornyn, meanwhile, he's continuing to make a play for the Republican leadership in the wake of Mitch McConnell's announcement last week that he'll be stepping down. And of course, guys, Texas is an open primary. Any registered voter could participate in either the Democrat or Republican primary today. And we learned today that Dallas Minority Mavericks owner, Mark Cuban, Shark Tank star, he's admitted to voting for Nikki Haley today in the Texas Republican primary, but says he'll be backing Joe Biden in the general election. And I have to say, Greg, in the theme of Shark Tank, you wonder if Nikki Haley looks at the results in Texas today and says, and for that reason, I'm out.
All right, gotcha.
Brilliant.
Mike, you're in the heart of Austin. Looks like there's a big nightclub.
It looks like Times Square, doesn't it?
What's going on? Why
you know what's funny? This is actually Joe Rogan's comedy cellar here. The comedy mothership is what they call it. A lot of comedians moved here to Austin during the pandemic. This has now become mecca for comedy across the United States. And so we're set up right outside. Tickets have been sold out all week. We've tried to get in.
I was going
to
say, I figured that's what you'll be doing when the show's over. Mike Carter, great to see you. Have fun.
All right, we've got our heavyweights at the table, Bob Brooks and Senator Rick Santorum. Senator, it's a privilege having you. You've been through this. You've been through primary night. You've won major primaries, caucuses. What are your thoughts so far?
It's a complete smackdown. I mean, it's a great night for Donald Trump. I mean, the margins of victory are every... I mean, look, the polls predicted this, but to actually see it and to see the turnout from everything I've seen, the turnout numbers are really... very strong on the Republican side. There's one mini bright spot for Nikki Haley. And
as Vermont?
I talked about earlier that if there was one state that Nikki Haley was going to be competitive in, it was going to be Vermont. And she has turned out to be competitive. And she actually may win it. I mean, we'll wait and see. But it's close enough at this point that she could. And looking at where the outstanding vote is, A lot of it's in the Burlington area, which is the area she's going to do well in. So it's going to be a very tight race. It'll be something interesting.
Vermont is where Bernie Sanders lives.
No, look, it's not a state that Republicans are going to win in the general election.
Right.
But if she wants to point to something to say, well, you know, I'm still in this.
She needed another so-called victory, obviously, after winning Washington, D.C., which is really no surprise. But, Bob, you know, if say she does take Vermont, or even if it's close at the end, how is the media going to spin this tomorrow if Nikki Haley is still in this race as of 12:01 a.m.?
Maybe that unaffiliated voters are more akin to, you know, the other side at this point. But, Senator, what'd you tell me earlier on my show today? You got to tell people till you're blue in the face, repeat it, repeat it, repeat it. Then finally they get reminded. And, Greg, we talked about this earlier today, about the fact that all that chaos, remember with former President Trump when he was in office, all the chaos that was drummed up around him and that he's been accused of, that it follows him everywhere, you know, the indictments against him, the impeachments against him.
Not his fault.
You could do that to anybody. If the machine on the other side wanted to do that to anybody, they could do it. They did it to him. So I wanted to remind people of that very point as we head into what looks like another matchup between Joe Biden and former President Trump, and then remind them of his record when he was president. Buck 80 for a gallon of gas, okay? Low inflation. Things were a lot different back then, and I think for a lot of Americans, they were a lot better. You're seeing the response.
So there's a question now remaining that, you know, if and when, because it looks likely when at this point, when Nikki Haley drops out, what happens to those supporters? We know a chunk of them are independents and Democrats. Let's listen to what some of her supporters had to say, and then I want to get your response, Rick.
The Republicans deserve a better choice, and I think that's Nikki Haley.
Is Nikki Haley someone you feel like you could vote for in November?
No. I will vote Democrat.
I would vote for Joe Biden over Donald Trump in a heartbeat.
I think she would do a very good job. Donald Trump is a threat to the well-being of our country.
She drops out. Would you be disappointed if she endorsed Trump?
If she does, I'll vote Democrat.
Trump versus Biden.
Biden problem.
So, Senator, you think
time
that's
out.
An accurate
wait.
Hey, wait a minute.
At a night when Donald Trump is just batting 1,000, we got the five people who hate him.
Yeah.
Anyway, Senator, what did you make of that?
No, look, this is the challenge that Trump has, and that's why tonight's his speech is a very important one. Is he going to give a speech like he did in Iowa, like he did in South Carolina, or is it going to be more combative like it was in New Hampshire? Now, every indication is it's going to be a unity speech. It's time to move on. He's clear he's not going to win the nomination tonight, but the nomination is, for all intents and purposes, was over. It is almost officially over now. And so the question is, can Trump pivot, move to try to unite the party, say some nice things about, you know, folks who ran against him? And you know, I understand people may, you know, may, but it's time to come together. Joe Biden's the problem, and then Biden, 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 Biden. That's got to be the message tonight.
Well, we've seen Joe Biden fail at unity. We'll see what Trump has to say tonight. Senator Santorum, Bob Brooks, I'll see you at both at 10 p.m.
Soon,
Thanks
Jen.
For being with
we'll
us.
Be me and you up here
That's
at
right.
10 starting.
All right. Thank you both. All right, folks, stay with us. Live look there at Mar-a-Lago, where President Trump set to speak in a short while. We'll keep an eye on that. Stay with us as our coverage of Super Tuesday continues. Welcome back, everyone. Newsmax can project President Trump has won the primary in Massachusetts over Nikki Haley there. Great news tonight. Another pickup for Trump.
I must admit, that was the state that I thought Nikki Haley had slightly more of a shot in. Personally, people know how I feel about her and Trump. I am pleased with these results, but I thought she might be slightly more competitive, but I think this is just
maybe in Vermont. She has Vermont.
That's right. However, well, the night is not over yet.
That's right.
All right, we have to move on to one of our favorites. We have Congressman Jim Jordan, Republican of Ohio, superstar down there. Great to see you again, Congressman
Jordan.
Good
with you guys.
You bet. Yeah. And Tristan Levitt, I understand, Tristan, you are the president of Empower Oversight, and you are representing some of the important whistleblowers. First, Congressman Jordan, what do you make of tonight so far?
Well, I think the American people know what's happened in, 3 years and 45 days of the Biden administration. We went from a secure border to no border. We went from safe streets to record crime. We went from $2 gas to $4 gas. We went from stable prices to record inflation. We went from a guy who projected strength from the Oval Office to our foreign, to our adversaries and to the world, in Donald Trump, to Joe Biden. And of course, we've had the government weaponized and turned against we the people, which we're going to talk about in a second. So when American people step back and say, I think I want more of Trump until he's winning big across the country, which is exactly what we need to happen. Most importantly, we need him to win in November, which I think he's going to.
Now, hopefully we can see some unity here as we move forward and look to November. Thank you, gentlemen, both for being with us. Let me ask you, Tristan, about what you're focused on. Marcus Allen, whistleblower, he had a compelling testimony back in May of last year exposing the FBI. I want to give our viewers a little bit of a flashback. Watch this.
It appears that I was retaliated against because I forwarded information to my superiors and others that questioned the official narrative of the events of January 6. As a result, I was accused of promoting conspiratorial views and unreliable information. Because I did this, the FBI questioned my allegiance to the United States.
All right, so that was almost a year ago, Tristan. What's the latest now that you can share with us?
So Marcus Allen continues to be in limbo with the FBI. He still has his security clearance suspended. He is not being paid, and he is just waiting for a decision from them. So we are trying to appeal that. He is a very patriotic individual who loves this country. He served in Iraq, served in the Marines. And so for him to still be not drawing a paycheck, but also prohibited from taking outside work is really just unconscionable on the FBI's part.
Congressman, you're all over this. The FBI is in desperate need of reform and probably in desperate need of a new director.
Well, very true. But in this particular situation, here's a guy who had stellar performance evaluations. Here's a guy who followed his chain of command, but simply said, let's just be honest. Let's tell the truth. Let's be fair in our perspective here. And because he says those things and then comes forward and tells Congress what's going on, he gets retaliated against. And this is a problem, because every whistleblower that came to us from the FBI, not everyone, but almost all of them, have been retaliated against. Their security clearance, as Tristan mentioned, has been suspended. And they're basically in this, as Tristan said, in this limbo, in this state where they can't really go anywhere, do anything. They can't move forward. And it's just flat out wrong. But it's just one more problem we've seen with the Justice Department and with the FBI.
All right. Congressman Jim Jordan, Tristan Leavitt, thank you both for being with us tonight on the Super Tuesday. We appreciate it.
You bet. Thank you.
Take care. Hey, Ted Cruz just won his seat. He was reelected in Texas. Newsmax can project. And I am pleased. I like Ted Cruz. I know he's got his detractors out there, but he's super, super brilliant. He's America first. And I like how he and Trump, you know, buried the hatchet a long time ago.
I like that, too. Yep.
All right. Good for Texas and good for America. Tom Basile is standing by.
Tom's at the wall. All right. Tom, what's the latest?
All right, guys, I got a couple of interesting things to show you here. I want to go to North Carolina. We've been following this, obviously. Former President Trump way ahead, and turnout on the Republican side is also way up. When you think about it, even though people kind of knew this was a fait accompli, we're seeing really strong Republican turnout numbers. But I want to flip over to the Democrat side. I've been watching this number. 70% of the votes in, no preference, has now pushed Joe Biden under 90, 88.8%. 50,000 people showed up and put no preference in the Democratic primary in the state of North Carolina. So that's very, very interesting to keep an eye on. And we'll also see if we're going to see that potentially in Minnesota as well, where you also have Dean Phillips. That's his home state. Some additional numbers coming in. Real preliminary in Minnesota, Donald Trump up 79% to 17%. And in the state of Colorado, we're getting a little bit more here, 97% of the vote in. And if you drill down into this, you could see Nikki Haley, if you look at places like Arapahoe County and also in Denver, Nikki Haley not performing nearly as strong as she needed to in order to really make a play in Colorado. So we're going to continue to keep an eye on all of this as the night progresses, but continues to be a very, very strong historic night for the former president.
Thanks a lot, Tom. You know, Donald Trump at Mar-a-Lago, we're expecting to see him in a little while. You know he's watching TV right now.
Oh, he is. I hope he's watching Greg Kelly.
Well, he's probably flipping around the dial, but I'm sure he's checking out Newsmax. And it is just a remarkable moment. I mean, we haven't really, have we ever seen anything like this? Not a one, oh, wait,
Don Jr. in the crowd there.
Oh, sure enough.
Greeting with some supporters.
Who else do we recognize?
A guy in a green hat. No, I don't know who these
John
people are.
John Huddy's there somewhere. We just can't see him. He's probably grabbing some people.
All right. Well, stay with us, folks, for our special Super Tuesday, Super Tuesday night coverage. All right. Take a look at this exit poll, please. Do you agree that the nation is on the right track? Of Democrats, 47% said it's on the right track. Republicans, 7%. Did not break 50 for Democrats. I think they're putting a positive spin on it, perhaps, in their own brains. Let's bring in the experts, though, shall we, Jen?
We shall. Let's see. We've got Rob Astorino and Mark Halperin with us tonight, gentlemen. So glad to have you here on this great evening. Mark, let me ask you, you think Democrats are feeling confident tonight about Joe Biden, where he's headed? Obviously, the polling's not great, but he says we're looking at the wrong polls, apparently.
He likes the polls where he's ahead. He's becoming quite Trump-like. I'm ahead in the polls that I like. I have had an extraordinary 10 days of incoming calls from Democrats and emails and texts, not just elite Democrats, but Democrats from around the country. Who now are in different places about Joe Biden, but all discouraged. Some don't want him to run. Some are angry at him for running. Some want him to run and do better. Some want him to run and do better in different ways. But they are not a confident party right now. And tonight is not going to help. Thursday, the State of the Union, could help. But it's not a problem that is going to be solved in a day. And time's running out. Voters make their decisions, for the most part, by the fall, early fall, maybe the summer. And so the level of panic is quite high, and it's mostly quiet and behind the scenes. But tonight, I think, is just going to make them all realize that they've got one guy who's going to give a speech tonight, right, and come out and give his big energetic speech, and then a guy who we won't see tonight.
Right, and we know as of this week, Michelle Obama says she's not going to run, so that takes away one potential candidate, one challenger.
Mark never thought she was going to run. I still think there's a chance. There's a chance.
She says no.
I've wasted hours talking to Greg and others about this. Hours. I need my time back.
You know what? You never say never. And Rob
Gavin's
Astorino.
Gavin's waiting in the shadows, though, I think.
Rob, what are your observations right now?
Nothing surprising tonight. I mean, you know, what are we're on edge to see if Vermont goes to Nikki Haley. It's like, who cares? I mean, if she's not preparing her goodbye speech right now, then she's doing a very big disservice to the country and to the Republican Party, more importantly. If she wants any future, she better make that speech tonight or tomorrow, and that's it. Donald Trump had a great night. I mean, I don't know how else to say it. He had a great night. I mean, look at Virginia was supposed to be close. It wasn't. He won states like Maine comfortably. He won Massachusetts comfortably. So he did well in the Northeast. Vermont's always crazy. It's, you know, Ben and Jerry's country.
He is doing well. Got a little more news, guys. Newsmax can now project Donald Trump capturing Minnesota tonight.
All
right. As those numbers roll in.
Hey, Mark. 1%. If she doesn't get out, I mean, what, and she has no future in the Republican Party. She probably not this cycle or in 28. What other motive would there be for her to stay in?
Well, first of all, she'll continue to raise money, I think, based on what I've been told. And that's unusual. I don't think this is an overstatement. No one who's had her level of electoral loss has raised the kind of money she's raising. It just doesn't happen. Because normally the donors say, I'm not betting on someone who can't win. So she can keep going. I think at this point, her bet that, well, if Trump somehow can't be the nominee, it will be her. I just don't think that's a good bet anymore because the people who would pick the nominee are Donald Trump, the RNC, or the RNC delegates. And so I don't really know what her game is. I used to have a little rap about why she might be going forward. I got no rap anymore.
Well, you think Donald Trump's going to be what kind of Donald Trump are we going to see tonight? I like all versions, but I keep hearing we're going to have a kinder, gentler. You see, he's got the whole country doing it.
He's in his element, right? He's at his home at Mar-a-Lago. He's got some of his top supporters there, his family. We saw Don Jr. there.
So is it a combative going after Nikki Haley, or is it?
I hope not. I don't think so. I think it's going to be more like his speech, his remarks after the Supreme Court decision. I thought those were very well done. You know, this is about America, bringing America together, blah, 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 blah. That's what he has to do. And I think the Iowa Donald Trump better than the New Hampshire Donald Trump. And look, this is the beginning of the general election. You know, I think in everyone's mind now, it's over with. This is the beginning. So now do it the right way. Go out and get those people who like your policies but still a little hesitant of you but hate Biden and what's going on in this country. Get them.
50% gracious, 50% Don Rickles.
You know, hit him hard, insult comedy. Can I just ask you this, though? The other day, I saw Joe Biden, who's at the border, and you know what he did? He said, Mr. President, you could join me in this, or I could join you. And, you know, I don't think it was sincere, but it was the first time I can remember Joe Biden not referring to Donald Trump as some sort of existential threat. And it harkened back to normalcy, which I kind of liked, although I don't need normalcy. But was that a significant moment?
Totally disagree with you. I thought it was both insincere and off-brand.
I agree.
Well, it was insincere and off-brand, but refreshingly nice.
Because he wants to blame Trump, Greg. He wants to blame Republicans for the border crisis.
He said 2 weeks ago they leaked out. There are going to be executive actions. He's going to get really tough on the border. We haven't seen them, and I don't think we will see them. He didn't want to work with Donald Trump. That his whole campaign is saying you can't work with Donald Trump. So what is an abnormal voter supposed to say? All of a sudden he's like, work with me, Mr. President. It doesn't make any sense.
It was the one time where the tone was Donald Trump. He didn't say he was a threat to national security. He didn't say he's going to burn down the country. He was saying what politicians say, insincere stuff about working together. And in a bizarre way, I found it refreshing.
I would like you to go get in a Corvette, drive around America, and find one voter who thought that was lovely and refreshing and made them more likely to vote for Joe Biden. I didn't get it. I thought it was way off brand.
All right. Thank you, Mark, and thank you.
Remember Monday Night Football, Danny Don Meredith? Turn out the lights, the party's over. That's the Nikki Haley song tonight.
Turn out the lights, the party's over.
That's right.
I don't remember it. Sorry. No, I don't remember it.
He's going all the way.
That I remember. That's
all right, I guess you're going to sing us to break. all right, gentlemen, thank you. And again, there, a look at Mar-a-Lago as the crowd awaits their president in his speech. Stay with us.
Super Tuesday continues right here on Newsmax.
Continues. Glad to have you with us. Let's welcome in former White House advisor Sebastian Gorka. Seb, great to see you tonight. It is a Super Tuesday indeed. We're seeing once again a lot of wind. Former President Trump waiting on his speech tonight. Your thoughts as we watch these results come in?
Truly historic. What is it? Oh, it's only been about 9 hours since we last spoke. Look, this is just the continuation of the trend line we've seen in the last six primaries. The fact that this man is setting records, he's breaking Democrat records. Look at prior trend line. The fact that New Hampshire, not exactly MAGA country, and he beats Bernie Sanders' results back then. That should have told you everything you need to know about tonight. You know, the clean sweep. Why is Vermont, why are other channels focusing on Vermont and Nikki Haley? Because it's an open primary and the Democrats are voting for Nikki Haley. So this is the remarkable resurrection of MAGA, of America First. And it's the American people saying, you know what? That question Ronald Reagan asked in 1979, are you better off than you were 4 years ago? That same question is being asked right now and they have one answer. We want Donald Trump back.
It is amazing. And, you know, Sebastian, they indicted him. They literally had him arrested. And they thought that his base, the people who believe in him, the people who voted for him the first time, the people who want him, would run. We'd see that mugshot, and we'd panic, and we would believe the fake news reports. And the opposite happened. And I wonder, the Democrats, I don't think they planned for this phase. They did not. Strategically thinking, I don't think they banked on having Donald Trump as a factor in March of 2024.
They didn't, and they're still a hostage to their own ideology, Greg. I mean, look at what's happened in the last 2 years. Every time, Alina Haber has beautifully mapped this out for us outside the courtroom in Washington, D.C., that amazing press conference, where she said, oh, isn't it interesting? As soon as there's a new revelation about Joe Biden, Hunter Biden, money from China, gifts of diamonds, Porsches, you name it, within 24 hours, literally within 24 hours, there's another indictment of the president. But what happens? He gains in popularity. He gets more and more donors. And the remarkable thing is, if the viewers have missed it, go online. I posted it on my Twitter feed. I posted it on Facebook. Go to President Trump's speech from CPAC a week ago. Because I don't know a man like this, Greg. he makes jokes about the political persecution. He told a joke about how he's flying over a blue state in Trump Force One, and he says to Melania, we've just flown over a Democrat state. I guess by the time I land, I'll be indicted again. What man who's facing 730 years in prison jokes about it? A man who loves this country and will not be stopped.
That's right. Seb, thanks so much for being with us. Look forward to hearing from President Trump a little bit later tonight.
Thank you, Sebastian.
I always appreciate you.
God bless. Thank you, guys.
All right. Let's bring in the host of Dick Morris Democracy, Dick Morris, who joins us now. Dick, great to see you. Listen, great night, obviously, for President Trump. No surprises here, really. The big question is, though, what do you think is going to happen on the other side? Joe Biden having an okay night, but there's been some news this week that the Clintons are getting involved again. New York Magazine reporting that. How is this playing out? Is this going to be the Trump-Biden rematch in November?
I think that it'll be the Trump rematch. I don't believe Biden is going to run. I think that they're going to put in Michelle Obama. Her office issued a statement today, and the statement said, and I'm reading it now, as former First Lady, Michelle Obama has expressed several times over the years she will not be running for president, said her director of communications. Mrs. Obama supports President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris's re-election campaign. First of all, if you're going to say that and make it stick, she should do it herself, not her press secretary. And secondly, this falls far short of what General Sherman said in the Civil War when they asked him if he would run for president. And he said, if nominated, I refuse to run, and if elected, I refuse to serve. The fact that she's putting it out there and tying the fact that she's not going to run to her support for Obama and for Harris and for Biden, I think indicates that she's probably going to run. I think that she's going to be pressured to get into it. The Democrats cannot accept these polls. They can't live with a candidate who's as far down as Biden is, and there's no possibility of a comeback. And they're not going to let the presidency be taken away from them without giving a run at Michelle Obama. And the argument that she doesn't want it, that it's not her cup of tea, that's all baloney. That's all posturing so that she can be seen to have been chased by the party and not been ambitious in much the same way George Washington and Thomas Jefferson did. Oh, I don't want to be president, but the office wants me. And I think it's all BS. I think that she is running for president.
I tend to agree with you, Dick, and fascinating. I didn't notice that, but you're right. She didn't say anything. Her office did. And right. We're in a situation right now where Joe Biden is still officially running for president. So whatever her office said is essentially meaningless because, as you and others anticipate, he's dropping out. He's going to drop. This is impossible. It's virtually impossible for this man to go on. I mean, the media can only cover up so much.
Yes, that's completely true. And if she were not going to run, if Michelle Obama were out of it, she would go in front of the cameras herself and say, look, there are rumors that I'm going to run for president, but I'm not. I'm supporting Biden and Harris, and I don't want to be president. So I'm not going to run for president. It's not in my blood. It's not in my whatever. And she didn't say that. She didn't go on the air herself. And I think that any statement that she's not going to run now is just being too cute by half. She needs to pretend that she doesn't want it. She needs to pretend that she's being forced to do this for the good of America. The Republic is in danger because Donald Trump is coming, and I have to put aside my personal preference to retire to Monticello or Mount Vernon or wherever she goes and get into politics, and I'm going to do that for the country. And that's what you're looking at here. This is all just precursor for that.
That's pretty wild, Dick. You know, you were so right about President Trump. You put it in a book, The Return. Some people thought you were crazy. You nailed it. And I think you're right about Michelle Obama. It's going to be wild.
Crazy and not necessarily wrong. But I was right in that book. I said that he'd run. Yes. I said he'd nomination. I said he'd almost win it unanimously. And that's happening now.
You're amazing, Dick. You're brilliant. And we'll see you later, okay?
Thanks, Dick.
Jen, I got to get out of here, but I'm going to leave things with you. And Donald Trump will be speaking, we think, in just a couple of minutes.
That's right. Looking forward to that. Thanks for having me tonight, Greg. Always a pleasure to be with you, my friend.
Oh, wait.
I'm sorry? We're going to be back. I'm not leaving.
It's 9:55. We still have 5 more minutes. Right. We'll see you after the break.
President Trump, we expect him to speak very shortly from Mar-a-Lago on this great big Super Tuesday,
Jen. That's right. We've got John Huddy down there. We'll bring Trump to you uninterrupted when he takes the stage. And obviously still waiting on some polls to close. We've got Utah, California, and Alaska still out there.
All right. Well, thanks for watching us. Our coverage continues.
Vote for America. 2024. Super Tuesday.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Newsmax's special coverage of Super Tuesday. I'm Jen Pellegrino.
And I'm Bob Brooks. Today marking the most consequential day in the 2024 race for both parties' presidential nominations. 16 states and one territory nominating contest today to pick their candidates. Polls have now closed in all but a handful of states. Polls in the state of Utah closing in 1 hour, where 40 delegates, Jen, are up for grabs.
That's right. For both Republicans and Democrats, more than one-third of the total delegates available are awarded on Super Tuesday. The magic number to secure the nomination, 1,215. Trump winning all primary contests against challenger Nikki Haley up to this point, except Washington, D.C., of course. But could tonight's results mark the end of Nikki Haley's campaign?
Well, we will see shortly here. Plus, can Trump continue his momentum and win all 15 states tonight? He's expected to speak shortly amid his unprecedented primary streak. We will bring you that live as soon as he takes the podium, plus all the results from across our great country.
All right, and we are joined tonight by our very special superstar guest. We have former White House Strategic Senior Advisor Mercedes Schlapp and former Pennsylvania Senator and Senior Political Analyst Rick Santorum. Mercedes, I'm going to start with you ladies first. Your thoughts on the results so far? Not too many surprises tonight.
Not too many surprises. In fact, this should be called like Lame Tuesday at this point in time because it was so predictable. President Trump obviously winning so many states, winning strong. I think Rick Santorum and I have had this ongoing bet about Vermont that he's very excited about because Nikki Haley could possibly win.
Not excited, it's the only competitive race.
Endorsed by the popular moderate governor there from the state of Vermont. But again, that, you know, you have independents that can vote in that primary. So look, Nikki Haley does well with independents and Democrats and that faction of Never Trumpers. That's about it. She hasn't been able to really bring any additional enthusiasm. The Republican Party is clearly in the camp of Donald Trump.
Senator, what do you make of this? A lot of momentum for the former president here.
Yeah, I sort of have to always take a step back and look where this started and where we are now, because we really haven't had that many primaries. This is, I mean, 5 or 6, which, you know, there's 57. Like Barack Obama, 57 states. Or 57, the reason he said that was because there are 57 primaries. And Donald Trump was in a competitive race a year ago. There were multiple candidates. Why were there multiple candidates? Because people thought he was vulnerable. People thought he could be beaten. And if you looked at the polls, there was some evidence that he could be beaten. And he was able to pull it all together. Now, there's a variety of different factors. I think he has to tip his hat a little bit to the Democrats for the lawfare that was thrown at him, and they made him a martyr. And he's not dead yet, which is pretty amazing to be a martyr and not be dead.
Clearly,
and that's what he's accomplished here. So, Trump, for all the criticisms you can level at him, it's been a remarkable accomplishment for him. Tonight's a capstone to that. This race was, in many respects, over, but you can't say it's over until a big chunk of people have voted. Now a big chunk of people have voted, and you're seeing 70%+ margins in almost every state. And now I think you reach a point where the Republican voter from this point on is saying, well, Nikki Haley may not realize the race is over, but we do. And so I think her numbers are only going to go down from here, because even folks who are supportive of her say, you know, Why are we wasting time doing this at this point? That's what happened to me in 2012 when I ran. I reached a point where people looked at the math and said, yeah, he can't get there. We like him. We don't like the other guy. But, you know, this has got to end. And I think that's where we are.
For the record,
you know,
Rick, I would have picked you over Nikki Haley, but that's for a different conversation.
You. Listen, we talk about this a lot. There's a lot of frustration in this country right now. Trump, in a lot of his speeches, talks about the decline that the nation has seen under Joe Biden. And tonight, we just saw a live look there at Mar-a-Lago. John Huddy's down there. You see the crowds gathering. They're excited. A lot of positive energy there tonight, Mercy. We're looking, obviously, to Nikki Haley at some point exiting this race. That's kind of in the cards at this point. But Trump obviously has a message to deliver. What do you think that's going to be tonight? Is there a lot of people that maybe, well, some people that may be on the fence that he would need to win?
Look, I think President Trump gave a very strong speech in Iowa when he talked about unifying the party. So I think going back to that speech will be very, very critical in saying, okay, we're in general election mode. We got to hone in on stopping Joe Biden. I'm the only one that can do it. I think when you talk to Republican voters, they're always the same thing. It's the same message, which is that Donald Trump fights. And the people like the fighter. And that's why you've seen in the latest polls, 89% of Republicans, they're going to back Donald Trump. And even if he's convicted, 86% of Republicans still back Donald Trump. Those are very strong numbers. His enthusiasm is growing. His voters are backing him up. I think, you know, the key will be now he has to start bringing up about those independents and those that feel that Joe Biden is a weak president that's creating chaos and uncertainty in our country.
Quickly, what's their number one issue? Sorry to interrupt you.
Number one issue for Republicans is immigration.
For the independents, though.
For the independents, it's going to be between immigration and the high food prices and the lingering inflation that is impacting American families.
Cost of living.
I have never heard, and correct me, you've listened to more than I have, but I've never heard Donald Trump directly address people who didn't vote for him. And because he generally is critical of people who don't support him and don't vote for him. I think tonight's an opportunity to something that people won't expect. For Trump to go out there and say, look, I know there are 20-some percent or whatever it is who didn't vote for him. Let me tell you why you should come on board. And a little bit of humility and say, you know, there may be reasons you didn't vote for me, maybe not. But here's why, you know, here's why it's now time to come together. You know, we've got these serious problems, and it's down to two choices.
Yeah, Senator,
and it's time to make the choice, you know, for the better choice, which is him.
Guys, real quick, sorry not to cut you off. I know that window, Senator, as you've mentioned, is still open. But right now we want to go live down to our senior correspondent, John Huddy. He's live at Mar-a-Lago at the watch party and where former President Trump is expected to speak any moment. John, what do you got for us?
Well, I'm keeping an eye out because his campaign just confirmed that former President Trump will be giving remarks at 10:15. So we're getting very close. I can tell you this, and I'm kind of watching. There's been senior members of his campaign staff, his senior advisors, his lawyers, some of his lawyers coming in here, his family members, Donald Trump Jr., and other senior staff members and longtime friends. I've seen friends of his coming in of 40 years of former President Trump. One thing I want to mention just real quick, Jen and Bob, the last time I was here in the Grand Ballroom at Mar-a-Lago was back on April 4th, 2023. That was the day that Donald Trump was arraigned in court in New York in the civil fraud case. And then, as you recall, he flew back here and he gave a speech that night, a very historic night, a very intense night, where he said he was going to fight like hell and that he wasn't going anywhere. The campaign would continue. And now here we are just shy of a year. And he is the presumptive GOP nominee as he continues to win state after state after state. It was Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina, and now on Super Tuesday. What we're expecting real quick to hear from former President Trump tonight is what some of the central issues, as you were just talking about, really drilling down on some of these issues, chiefly among them immigration. As the exit polls have shown, that's really one of the main concern on voters' minds, not only tonight, but also it was in South Carolina, New Hampshire, Iowa. He talked about it yesterday during his remarks here at Mar-a-Lago. Presumably he's going to talk about that again tonight, along with the economy, inflation, and really the main focus, beating Joe Biden. Back to you.
All right, John Huddy there in a crowded ballroom. Great energy in that room. We're going to keep an eye on that speech. He says 10:15. Folks, don't go anywhere. More coverage of tonight's Super Tuesday results right after the break.
Okay, welcome back. Let's take a look at a very tight race in the state of Vermont. Polls close there at 7 p.m. Eastern, and it remains too early to call. Well, of course, we will be monitoring this race closely and bring you the results as soon as we have them.
And welcome back, everyone, to Newsmax's Super Tuesday coverage with over a third of GOP delegates up for grabs across the country. Many are speculating that tonight could be Haley's last stand. Keeping an eye on all of this as the numbers come in.
Yep, that's right. Her stance on that heading into today's contests, she says she's going to stay in the race as long as she is competitive. She told me that right here on American Agenda, my show, implying she'll drop out. If it's a blowout, though, we'll be sure to monitor any breaking developments and bring them to you live. But for more, let's bring back in our panel, Mercedes Schlapp, Senator Rick Santorum. Let's talk more about this speech we're about to hear from former President Trump, a speech of unity, as we were all discussing during the commercial break. What does that look like, Mercedes? How does he do it?
He's got to talk about America First policies and bring it back to what made America put in such a strong position, not only domestically, but internationally, right? So present the bleak contrast with what we're seeing with Joe Biden. Joe Biden's America is inflation, higher food prices, an open border, illegal aliens who are basically killing innocent Americans every day, crime-infested cities. Contrast that with President Trump when he was in office, where the economy was prosperous, where we had control of the border, where there weren't these multi-pronged wars happening across the globe. Americans want a return to stability, security, and prosperity. That's the message to deliver for President Trump, and I think he'll do that effectively tonight.
Senator, you know, we talk about the issues that are facing a lot of Americans right now. Obviously, immigration, the economy, and really immigration has surpassed the economy in a lot of the polls recently. We saw Trump down at the border this past week, along with Joe Biden, dueling visits in different parts of the state. Does that continue to be an issue going into the election? Do things shift?
Amazing thing about this race is the issue set sets up perfectly for Donald Trump. I mean,
let's pause here. We'll see it. Donald Trump walking out. Let's listen in. Here we are at Mar-a-Lago with his crowd of supporters, and he's going to make some remarks after all of these victories tonight on Super Tuesday. Who gave that right to me, and I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, because there ain't no doubt I love this land. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Well, thank you very much. They call it Super Tuesday for a reason. This is a big one. And they tell me, the pundits and otherwise, that there's never been one like this. There's never been anything so conclusive. This was an amazing night, an amazing day. It's been an incredible period of time in our country's history. It's been sad in so many ways, but I think it's going to be inspiring because we're going to do something that, frankly, nobody's been able to do for a long time. We've watched our country take a great beating over the last 3 years, and nobody thought a thing like this would be possible. We wouldn't have Russia attacking Ukraine. We wouldn't have Israel being attacked. Iran, as you know, was broke when I was running things. They were broke. They didn't have money for Hamas. They didn't have money for Hezbollah. We had no inflation. Inflation is destroying the middle class. It's destroying everything. Inflation, if you look back over the history, hundreds of years back, it's called inflation. It's called a country buster. And that's what it's doing to our country. What's happened with inflation has been unbelievable. A lot of people say, a lot of experts have said, the stock market's the only thing that's doing well, and that's doing well because our poll numbers are so much higher than Joe Biden's. He's the worst president in the history of our country. There's never been anything like what's happening to our country. Today it was announced that 325,000 people were flown in from parts unknown. Migrants were flown in airplane, not going through borders, not going through that great Texas barrier that I was with the governor of Texas, Greg Abbott, the other day, and we were looking at the job they're doing. But in the meantime, they're pouring into California and they're pouring into Arizona because those governors aren't doing anything. They're doing nothing. But today it was just announced before I came out. It was unbelievable. I said, that must be a mistake. They flew 325,000 migrants, flew them in over the borders, into our country. So that really tells you where they're coming from. They want open borders, and open borders are going to destroy our country. We need borders, and we need free and fair elections, or we don't have a country. This is an incredible group of people. So many celebrities that I'm not going to introduce any because I'm just going to get myself in trouble if I do that, because I'll leave out most of you. But we have, this is a room chock full of incredible, talented people, like some of the guys standing right in front of me, right? Big, big futures, big, fat, beautiful futures. Oh, I'd love to be your age. I'd pay you a lot of money to be your age. But we have some tremendously talented people in this room, including tremendously talented political people that have helped me right from the beginning. We had the safest border in the history of our country. We built 571 miles of wall. We had Mexico supply us with 28,000 soldiers because we wanted them, that's why. And they said, we won't do that. I said, yes, you will, you will. And in the end, they did. It was an easy negotiation, but we had the safest border, the best numbers we've ever had, and now we have the worst numbers probably in the history of the world. It's sad to see what's happening to our cities. Our cities are being overrun with migrant crime, and that's Biden migrant crime. But it's a new category of crime, and it's violent, where they'll stand in the middle of a street and have fistfights with police officers. And if they did that in their countries from where they came, they'd be killed instantly. They wouldn't do that. So the world is laughing at us. The world is taking advantage of us. 3 years ago, we were at a level. We were energy independent. We were going to be very shortly energy dominant. And today, we're getting oil from Venezuela. Can you believe it? And we're doing numbers on that oil. You know what we're doing? We're refining the oil. We have our refinery for that oil. It's really, I call it tar. It's not oil. It's terrible. We have real stuff. But we're refining it in Houston. So for all of the environmentalists, you ought to look at that, because all of that tar is going right up into the atmosphere. You just ought to take a look. It's the only plant that can do it. We have the only plants that can take tar and make it into oil. And that's what it is. It's a shame. But we were energy independent, We were going to be energy dominant. We were going to be supplying oil to Europe, all over the world. And then a tragic thing happened during the election. It was a tragedy because you wouldn't have, think of it, all of the problems that you have today, I don't think you would have had any of them. You'd only have success. And that's what's ultimately going to unify this country and unify this party. We have a great Republican Party with tremendous talent, and we want to have unity, and we're going to have unity, and it's going to happen very quickly. And I have been saying lately, success will bring unity to our country, and it happened before. We had the best economy our country's ever had, and people were calling me that I would have said, will never happen. It'll never happen. They wanted to get together African-American, Asian-American, Hispanic-American, women, men, people with diplomas from the best schools in the world, and people that didn't graduate from high school. Every single group was doing better than ever before, and it was a beautiful thing. Our country was coming together. Our country was coming together. And now we have a very divided country. We have a country that a political person uses weaponization against his political opponent. Never happened here. It happens in other countries, but they're third world countries. And in some ways, we're a third world country. We're a third world country at our borders, and we're a third world country at our elections. And we have to stop that. We need a fair and free press. The press has not been fair, nor has it been free, but maybe someday they will be. They're being beaten up pretty badly. People aren't trusting them. They're not believing them. And really, it's a very important factor. The press used to be the policeman. It used to police our country. Now nobody has confidence in them. And we have to get that confidence back. It's so important for the success of our country. So important. So this has been a day that we've been waiting for. I want to thank my family for being here. It's a great family. I have a great family. They've had it very easy since I decided to run for politics. They say, thanks a lot, Dad. We appreciate it. But they're strong, and they're very capable people, and they love the country. They really do love the country. And we appreciate it. And I want to thank everybody, my staff, Susie, Chris, incredible job. Incredible job you're doing. I read an article yesterday where it said this is one of the finest run campaigns that anybody has ever seen. That's pretty good, right? That's pretty good. It's really a statement. And we have no choice, because November 5th, it's right around the corner, November 5th is going to go down as the single most important day in the history of our country. We're going to take it, and we're going to make it like it should be, respected. Right now, we're not respected. Right now, our country is known as a joke. It's a joke. Other leaders who I speak to, other leaders can't believe what happened to us. Because 3 years ago, we were the most respected country anywhere in the world by far. We were doing things that nobody could believe. China was paying us billions and billions of dollars. In 25 years, they paid us nothing, zero, not 10 cents. I was getting billions of dollars, and they were happy about it, as happy as you can be. Of course, maybe there's reasons for things having happened, but they were not so happy with certain things, I guess, based on things that took place. But we were getting along with everybody. We were getting along, and we were respected by everybody. We had no wars. Remember when I had the debate with Hillary Clinton? She said, look at him. Look at that personality. He's going to cause wars, wars. I said, no, my personality is going to keep us out of wars. And that's what happened. For For 20 years, they were fighting ISIS. I defeated ISIS in 4 weeks. I got rid of ISIS 100%. 100% of the ISIS caliphate. And we had no wars, and we stopped wars. We weren't getting along with a lot of countries. All of a sudden, North Korea, which is a serious nuclear power, but North Korea came along. Kim Jong-un, we got along very well. We got along very well with China until COVID. That was a little bit too much, as far as I was concerned. That was too much. Couldn't take that one. But we made a trade deal with China that I don't even talk about. $50 billion a year in product they bought from our farmers, our manufacturers. They used to buy 10. I got 50, and it was great. But COVID, I don't even talk about that, because COVID was such a horrible thing. It started in the Wuhan labs, just as I said, the Wuhan labs. And it came out, I believe, through incompetence. I believe it was incompetence. Some people think it wasn't, but I believe it was. But regardless, it caused $60 trillion worth of damage and death all over the world, all over the world. And we did a fantastic job on that. We never got credit for that. Unbelievable job on that. We came up with things that nobody thought was possible. Don't forget, when it came in, nobody had an idea what it was. They didn't even use the word pandemic. Nobody had an idea. But we did a fantastic job. And we got a lot of credit for the economy, a lot of credit for our foreign policy. I think credit like nobody, very few people have gotten. And the press was very honest about it. They gave us very high marks on foreign policy, the Abraham Accords, so many different things we did. But we never got the kind of due that we should have for the COVID, or as I call it affectionately, the Chinese virus, the China virus, which is a much more accurate term. And despite that, the stock market, when we turned it over, the stock market was higher than it was prior to COVID coming in. It was an amazing thing. We did an amazing job, and we have so many people that worked on that, so many of the doctors, so many of the scientists that worked with us on that. It was really, really something. But there's never been an administration that had more success in so many different elements. We got the largest tax cuts in history. We have the largest regulation cuts in history. We rebuilt our military. And what happened, we rebuilt our entire military, and beautiful. We had jet fighters that were 53 years old, and we had all brand new jet fighters. And then after this other group of people that didn't know what they were doing, they took over, and we had that horrible surrender in Afghanistan. I call it a surrender. We took the soldiers out first. You know, I dealt with the leaders of the Taliban in Afghanistan. They were the ones that were causing the trouble. The press was very angry because they said, why are you calling them? I said, because that's where the problem is. I say oftentimes, I say, they asked Jesse James, Jesse, why do you rob banks? He said, because that's where the money is. And I said, that's where the problem is with the Taliban. And I spoke to Abdul. He's still the leader, believe it or not. He's really the leader of Afghanistan, but he's the leader of the Taliban. A rough group. I say, don't ever shoot our soldiers again. Don't ever do it. Very interesting what happened is that, you know, we were having, during the Obama administration, previously, they were shooting a lot of our soldiers. And I let them know, I said, don't ever, ever let that happen. I said very, in a rather nasty fashion. We don't have to go into it tonight. For 18 months, we lost nobody in Afghanistan. And then we had that horrible, horrible withdrawal where we lost 13 soldiers, 38 horribly wounded, left Americans behind. You know, you have Americans right now still behind. Call them hostages if you like. It was a terrible moment. We left $85 billion worth of brand new, beautiful equipment behind, jets and tanks and everything you can think of, goggles, night goggles. They didn't use to fight. They're good fighters. They didn't used to fight at night, but now they do because they have goggles. They have better goggles than we have. So I just want to tell you that led to a lot of bad things. And now the worst things are happening. The things that are happening now are unthinkable.
and they're unthinkable at the border. We have millions of people invading our country. This is an invasion. This is the worst invasion probably. We've never had anything like it. No country has ever had anything like it. The number today could be 15 million people. And they're coming from rough places and dangerous places. And we had that shut down. We had everything going so beautifully. When Joe Biden goes to the beach, because somebody on his staff thinks he looks very good in a bathing suit, until he can't get his feet out of the sand or lift the chair, which weighs about 9 ounces. Joe Biden, if he would have just left everything alone, he could have gone to the beach. He would have had a tremendous success at the border and elsewhere. So we're going to take back our country. We're going to make sure. We are going to do it right. We're going to have the greatest economy ever in the history of our country. We're going to top what we did. We're going to become an energy center of the world. We're ready to become energy dominant, and they stop that. They stop that. But we're going to become energy dominant. We're going to pay off debt. We're going to do things that nobody thought was possible. You know, we hadn't done our second phase of the tax cuts. Well, we did the tax cuts. The Democrats fought us very hard. And now they say, well, I guess that was pretty good because we took in much more revenues after we cut taxes. And then we did all of those regulation cuts and people were working and everybody was happy and we were all proud of our country. But we're going to win this election because we have no choice. If we lose the election, we're not going to have a country left. And we're going to do something. Thank you very much. We love you too. And we love our country. And we can't let this magnificent, some people call it an experiment. I don't call it an experiment. I just say this is a magnificent place, a magnificent country. And it's so sad to see how far it's come and gone. When you look at the depths of where it's gone, we can't let that happen. We're going to straighten it out. We're going to close our borders. We're going to drill, baby, drill. We're going to get the inflation down. And we are going to make our country greater than ever before. And we're going to do it quickly. We're going to do it quickly. It's going to go fast. We have to get the criminals out. We have many, many criminals that have entered our country. We have people coming in from such bad places, and we're going to have to get them out. We have murderers that are being deposited into our country. We have drug dealers at the biggest and highest levels that are coming into our country. We have people coming into our country that just shouldn't be here. But many, and I say many, large percentages, they come in through the caravans. They come in many different ways. Now we find out again, they come in through airplanes. We send them in. This is crazy. But they come into our country, we're going to stop them. We're going to close our borders. We're going to have to deport a lot of people, a lot of bad people, because our countries can't live like this. Our cities are choking to death. Our states are dying. And frankly, our country is dying. And we're going to make America great again, greater than ever before. Thank you very much. It's been a big night. Thank you very much. Thank you.
everybody. Former President Trump speaking there at Mar-a-Lago, addressing his supporters after a number of Super Tuesday victories, touching on a lot of the issues that Americans are focused on right now. The border, the crime going on as a result of the open borders, how divided this country has become, the attacks on supporters of his and the attacks on him as a candidate coming from the left, talks about the press. We need a fair and free press, among so many other issues. But just narrowing it down, this is a president that's focused on November. Nikki Haley is in the rear view for him. Mercy?
Yeah, no thoughts? Mention of really Nikki Haley. The line that stood out for me was, success will bring unity to our country. I think that's a huge line right there for President Trump, talking about Hispanics, African American, Asian Americans. They were all doing better when he was president, and he made mention of that. This goes to Rick's point. How is he going to drive these voters to support him? He then did that contrast that we talked about of Joe Biden with the open borders and inflation and all these wars, and then talked about Ukraine versus Russia, obviously the issue in Israel, and the importance of energy dominance, which is a topic that he mentioned a couple times. Strong speech. I think it talks about that unity message that I think it's important for him to do. And also, as you mentioned, it's about Biden. It is not about Nikki, not a word about his opponent, his Republican opponent.
I get the structure of the speech, and Senator, this was something we had discussed, I think, earlier. What is he going to do now to unify, which is, to Mercedes' point here, unify the country? Talked about his record first. All the things that went really well under him, stark contrast to Joe Biden, all the things that are going wrong under him, then he wrapped it up at home, bringing back and making America great again here. Very structured speech here, kind of what you thought was going to happen.
Yeah, it is. I mean, content-wise, it was pitch perfect. There was no question about that. He hit all the topics. But to me, which is, in my mind, was actually better, was the style in which he delivered it. One of the things that a lot of folks who are, I think, on the fence about Trump is they don't like the bombast, they don't like, you know, the showman, they don't like, you know, the hard driving toughness that that Trump can. And he was very subdued tonight. I mean, he was not elated. I mean, he wasn't spiking the football. I mean, I think that's one of the things you thought he might do, is go up there and sort of, no spiking the football, no, you know, I'm the greatest, this. It was very subdued, very measured, might I say very presidential. And so I think a lot of, again, what you can't, one of the things I learned in giving a lot of speeches, it's not so much what you say, it's how you say it, and the message you deliver by the way you deliver your speech and the tone in which you do it. My wife is always talking to me about my tone, so there. I mean, it's one of those things. His tone tonight was just very serious. I mean, I think you said as he was walking off stage,
all business.
It's all business.
Yes.
Tonight was all business. This was no fluff. He made a couple of cracks about Joe Biden, which is great.
It was kind of funny.
It was funny. That was good.
No, yeah, not that. That was a lot of laughs.
No,
that's
all within bounds. I thought he, in tone, did more to reach out to voters tonight than I've seen in a long time.
Guys, we want to get to this right here. We have an update from the state of Vermont and the primary going on up there. We mentioned earlier the Vermont primary, too early to call. Well, now Newsmax projects Nikki Haley has actually won the GOP primary in the state of Vermont here. I know, Senator, you made the prediction.
I did make that prediction. I don't want to say it, but yes, I did make this afternoon. I made the prediction. Okay. I thought she would win, and just the state line just lined up too much for her, now she can say that she not only is the first woman Republican to win a district, she is the first Republican presidential candidate to win a state.
Rick, so for
Bernie
the record,
Sanders, Vermont, by the way,
nobody cares. Really, nobody will remember, and nobody cares.
No, I understand that, but
it's truth.
Legacy media will. Tomorrow they're going to spin this somehow.
No, tomorrow they're going to say, "Oh, President Trump did. You know, he said wrong. You know, lies, and they didn't air the speech on MSNBC because, God forbid, they want to see anyone, you know, of their supporters listening to a Donald Trump speech, because that's what they do. The MSNBC censors, and that's a problem.
All right, folks, stay with us. Much more of Newsmax's Super Tuesday coverage up ahead. Welcome back to our special Super Tuesday coverage. Let's talk about the delegate count right now. 1215 is the total that's needed. Donald Trump currently with 640 delegates. Nikki Haley adding to her count tonight with 43.
Okay, right now we're going to get an update from our very own Tom Basile, who's standing by at the board here. I think he's going to break down how this all transpired there in
and
Vermont.
The biggest prize is yet to come. California closes at 11 p.m. Eastern. But something that I have been following all day has been this uncommitted vote. Joe Biden, is Joe Biden going to be impacted, his numbers, by uncommitted voters? People came out and said, yeah, we don't want him, we don't want anybody, and we're going to send a message. Let's take a look at the state of North Carolina and take a look at the Democratic primary there. 12%, we said earlier, will Joe Biden get pushed under 90? He's at 12.3% for no preference. In the state of Minnesota, same problem there. 20% of the folks who came out in Minnesota today with low turnout, 20% uncommitted. And in the state of Colorado, number two is also uncommitted, 7.3%, beating the other candidates in the race with 85% of the votes in. So, look, I think that's pretty significant when you think about we have a historically weak president, and you have folks who are coming out in that Democratic primary. They're trying to send a message to the country. They're trying to send a message to the Democratic Party. And we're seeing it in the polling data. We're starting to see it at the ballot box now.
Tom Basile, appreciate it.
Thanks, Tom. All right. Thoughts, panel?
Well, I would just say from Tom's, the most significant thing that he said to me in that commentary was Minnesota. The fact that 20%, number one, very low turnout in Minnesota. I mean, you're talking, just a little over 150,000 votes with almost 50% in. I mean, that's very low turnout, number one. Number two, 20% of the vote, and it's coming from the Somali community,
right,
where Ilhan Omar's district. I'm sure that's where most of that vote is coming from, at least in percent proportionately. And Minnesota is a state that Trump can do well in. I mean, everyone thinks, oh, Minnesota, it's Walter Mondale, it's the only state that Reagan lost or whatever, but it's not the same state. It's a very different dynamic. It's very blue collar in a lot of areas, Iron Range, et cetera. So that's a state that if this trend holds true, where a block of votes is going to leave Joe Biden, Minnesota can be put in play.
And we saw this in Michigan as well. So we saw a lot of these uncommitted voters did not want to support Joe Biden. Reason being is because of this pro-Hamas versus Israel argument that's happening in the Democrat Party right now, that big division, which is actually breaking apart Joe Biden's
kind of like a protest.
Yes,
against it. But the question I have is, does that transition to them not voting for Biden in the general election, or do they come home?
They could either stay home and not vote, or decide they're going to support Donald Trump. I think the likelihood is that they stay home.
Well, listen, guys, we've got some exit polling. It's coming in, gives us a good glimpse of tonight's voters, both Democrats and Republicans.
Yeah, that's right. And we are going to keep talking about that. Here they go. Super Tuesday exit poll for the top issue for the Democrat voters. Abortion standing at 27%. The economy, 25%. Education, 11%. Immigration, 9%. Foreign policy, 9%. Crime, 8%.
Let's pause right there, because abortion, that's a big issue. Republicans kind of tiptoeing around the messaging here. We know this drives out Democrat voters. What do you guys think? Can Republicans come out with a messaging that people can get on board with?
Absolutely. And this is an area that I think Trump can lead in. This is an area that actually Trump does a very good job of messaging, which is he goes out and goes on the offensive against Democrats for their extreme position on this issue. And yes, will that – he's going to lose the base hard left Democratic voter. He's not going to get them no matter what. But he will get a lot of folks who are concerned about the abortion issue. But number one, Trump is not for federal legislation. He's not a supporter of that. Number two, he's out there painting the Democrats for the extremists that they are. He's not. I mean, Trump on the issue of abortion right now, I would say, is a moderate Republican.
Right.
And he's making that claim, and he's going on the offensive, which is a pretty effective 1-2 punch.
The question now of IVF in Alabama bringing new light to the issue, and, of course, Democrats rallying around that.
I will say the Democrats have spent so much of their ad dollars on making the Republicans into the extreme by saying that there's going to be an abortion ban and all this language, and it has worked effectively for them. I would argue that within the Republican Party itself, there is infighting happening. There are those Republicans, pro-lifers, that want federal legislation. It's not going to go anywhere because they don't have the numbers in the Senate. But also, you see that there are those Republicans that want to keep it in the states. I think for Republicans, they have to stand strong and say the extremists are the Democrats on this issue. They should just really lean into this issue as opposed to trying to run away from it, because it is an issue.
If you don't talk about it, you lose.
Yeah, well,
that's what you've got to talk about.
Democrats are talking about it, putting the onus on Republicans.
And they're lying about it.
And then you just play defense.
And it's doing well for them.
Yes, and they're lying about it because they're making it seem that they're extreme on abortion. I will want to add that Joe Biden responded to Trump's speech by saying that Trump has an extreme plan to take us backwards, which is just fascinating.
Back in chains.
Folks, we have a lot to discuss, obviously. Keep it right here on Newsmax. We're going to tick down to the California polls closing. Stay with us.
Okay, welcome back. We're going to talk about the polls in the state of California closing in just moments, with a big race to watch out there tonight. The battle for Dianne Feinstein's Senate seat. 27 candidates have filed for her seat, with the four leading contenders being Democrats Adam Schiff, Katie Porter, Barbara Lee, plus former baseball star and legend Republican Steve Garvey. Now, the winner of this race will not only fill Feinstein's 2025 open seat, but also complete her term in the final weeks of 2024.
That's right. The twist: California has a top two primary, so instead of voters selecting the top Democrat and the top Republican for the general election in November, California will choose the top two candidates to move on regardless of party. So it's going to be interesting. The GOP's Steve Garvey has been the one to watch. In recent polling, he has been in a statistical tie with Adam Schiff. A Republican has not won a Senate race in California since 1988.
Been a long time. We'll see what happens. Our very on Addison Smith. He's at the Republican Party of San Diego, their watch party. Addison, what's the mood out there in the Golden State? What can you tell us?
Yeah, the mood is electric, to put it simply. People are very excited. The polls close in about 4 minutes, 8 o'clock local time, 11 o'clock Eastern. People are very excited for this race, guys. Of course, you mentioned Steve Garvey, the LA Dodgers legend. He is gunning for that Senate seat that the late Dianne Feinstein once held. And of course, Congressman Adam Schiff is basically his top contender. And it's interesting because Garvey hasn't run for public office. He hasn't even ran a television ad. And he is nonetheless in a statistical tie with Adam Schiff for this seat. So it's going to be very interesting to watch. You mentioned that California hasn't had a Republican senator since 1988, so people are looking forward to that. I just talked to San Diego Republican County Chairwoman Paula Witzel. She feels good about the chances here tonight. And of course, the elephant in the room, no pun intended, the Republican presidential primary, former President Donald Trump, polling at 83% here in California in some of the recent morning consult polling. I've seen a lot of Trump hats walking around. I don't see any at the moment, but seen a lot of Trump supporters around. They're ready to see President Trump really put a bow on this primary race. Of course, Nikki Haley, she does not have any public events listed on her website. She's not holding a public event tonight. It's looking like she knows that the writing is on the wall. Of course, we'll see if she has any announcement to make. But again, polls close in 2 minutes now, so we'll see and report back to you what we find, guys.
Addison Smith from the state of California. Thank you, sir. We appreciate it.
You bet.
All All right, let's bring in Mercedes Schlapp and welcome in GOP strategist Joe Pinion. Joe, great to see you. Glad to have you here on the panel tonight.
Always great to be with you guys.
It is a super Tuesday, as President Trump said earlier. What do you think about the race in California here? You saw Addison out there with Steve Garvey's campaign. Can a Republican win this time around in the Golden State?
Well, look, there's the good news and the bad news. The good news is that you've got a California legend who is running. The good news is that he's running against a man who not only shouldn't be in the United States Senate, he shouldn't be anywhere near a ballot. He shouldn't be able to be elected dog catcher in Adam Schiff. So that's the good news. The bad news is, if you look at presidential years, 2020 in particular, I mean, you're talking about a 5 million vote gulf in California between what Joe Biden was able to do and what President Trump was able to do. That's kind of typical for California. So an uphill battle nonetheless. But I think, again, just for the audience to put that in context, a state like Texas, which we assume is red, 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 you're looking at a gulf of only around 600,000 votes. So, again, just shows you how much they have destroyed that beautiful state that Ronald Reagan was once the governor of. But joy cometh in the morning, so we should stay tuned.
If anyone can do it, a legend like Steve Garvey?
Well, remember, there was a famous celebrity, Arnold Schwarzenegger, who was a Republican governor, right? He won, he led the state. And so, look, let's not count Garvey out of this race. The key will be is that the Democrats will make sure that they're going to basically infuse millions of dollars into that race to make sure they don't lose that Senate seat. But what we can find is, since it will be the top two, Schiff and likely Garvey, that's going to take out Katie Porter and Barbara Lee, those two congressional members who obviously were attempting to be that number.
All right. We got to pause there. Mercedes and Joe, thank you. Stay with us. Folks, keep it right here on Newsmax. More of our Super Tuesday special coverage starts right now.
Vote for America 2024. Super Tuesday.
Okay, everybody, welcome back to our Super Tuesday special coverage. It is now 11 p.m. and the polls in California have just closed, a state where 169 GOP delegates are up for grabs, the biggest prize of the day.
Also in California, we are keeping an eye on the Senate race results, where two of the top candidates will advance to the general election to fill the late Dianne Feinstein seat. The top contenders, former baseball star and Republican Steve Garvey, against Democrats Adam Schiff, Katie Porter, and Barbara Lee. We'll bring you those results as soon as they come in. But we're going to kick this off with Mercedes Schlapp and Joe Pinion joining us here for this second hour. Glad to have you guys back with us. Mercy, what should we be looking out for tonight that perhaps we haven't touched on this evening?
Well, I think the obvious is that Nikki Haley has nowhere to go, and it's time for her to pack her bags and follow her next career, whatever it may be, in a boardroom, in corporate America. But she really has no path to victory. And I think she was counting on all these legal trials that the president was facing for her to at least make some inroads or make her case to the American people that they should look elsewhere. Donald Trump is dominating the field, dominating the party, and ready to take on Joe Biden. And I think the Republicans are more than ever before unified to make sure that that happens.
Now, we also want to make note that in the speech the former president gave, he didn't even mention Nikki Haley. I think that says a lot, no?
Oh, yes.
The fact he didn't mention her, she has no planned events here moving forward. Joe, so let's talk the future. What's coming next? How does the former president expand his base now and get the votes he needs to take down Joe Biden?
Well, I think you heard a little bit of that at the beginning of that speech.
Joe, hang on one moment. We are going to project now, Newsmax projecting Trump's victory in the state of California. As many expected. Continue on, Joe.
Look, I think it speaks volumes to the fact that about a minute after the polls closed, we're able to call these states in favor of President Trump, because I think, to Mercedes' point, there is no pathway for Nikki Haley. It reminds me of you miss your exit on going down the highway, and all of a sudden you've got to drive 2 miles to make a U-turn and come back. And so there was a point where she could have gracefully exited stage right in South Carolina. They chose not to do that. And now I feel like she's in political no no man's land. So, again, time will tell. But back to President Trump making his case about what needs to happen. It's a country that is in disarray because of an economy that doesn't work. They can whisper Bidenomics from now till November. The American people know that their bank account is not working. A southern border that has become a gangster's paradise. You look at the disarray around the world where they said President Trump is going to start World War III. Meanwhile, there's Joe Biden that has us staring down the gauntlet of World War III, from Gaza to Ukraine and Russia to what we know is happening in the South China Sea. So these are just the realities. And that's before you even get to something crazy like the president of Haiti being assassinated on Joe Biden's watch. And now we see what's happening right now, just 600 miles away from the U.S. border. Lots of crazy, crazy things happening down there, praying for those people in Haiti.
Well said.
Indeed. All right, Joe Pinion, Mercedes Schlapp, thank you. For more, let's go and welcome in our polling analyst as well as writer for The Hill and American Spectator, Keith Naughton. Keith, thank you so much for joining us. We'd like to get your take on some of the exit polls that we're seeing this evening. I believe we have some of those to put up on the screen.
Sure. Okay, let's take a look at them here. We know that the top issue for the Democrat voters, abortion, we discussed this earlier today, followed by the economy, education, and then immigration, while the top issue for Republican voters is by far immigration, is then followed by economy and abortion. Some common themes between the two here. What do you think, former President Trump, what he does targeting voters in these issues here, and then also the path Joe Biden's going to take here?
Well, I think Trump had a good start. For one thing, he didn't talk for an hour, so that's a good move on his part. You want to stick to your main points, and I think he was very succinct. I think he went at immigration, which matters for Republicans, but it also matters for independents. And I think that's a real key thing, is that Republican voters and independent voters tend to be tracking the same way on the issues, on immigration and on the economy. Democratic voters are not on the same reservation. They're on the other side of the fence. They're more with abortion. And I've seen other polls, they're in with environmental and climate change is very high with them. That's not high for Republicans or independents. So Trump is in a good position on the issue side, and that really counts in the election.
Keith, of course, we're still 8 months out from the general election. How much emphasis should we be placing on these polls at this point? You know, we hear Joe Biden out there when the press asks him about his polls. He says, well, you're looking at the wrong polls. There are some polls that are positive for me. You know, obviously, there are things that could change. But what would you tell people out there that are seeing all these polls and saying, yep, looks like Donald Trump has this all tied up in November?
Well, anyone who complains about the polls is someone who's behind. So let's just keep that in mind. But it is early. There's a lot of time to go. Nothing is in the bank right now. And there are two issues that are dogging each of these candidates. Biden's got this age issue, and he is way behind on it. Independent voters are concerned about it. Republicans, obviously, are concerned about it. Even a section of Democrats are concerned about it. And yeah, he's not Benjamin Button. He's not getting any younger. So that's going to dog him the whole way. President Trump has a temperament problem. The recent New York Times poll had him down to Biden on this temperament issue, 53 to 39. Biden was plus 10 overall, and the former president was minus 20. And Donald Trump's not changing. He's got his own style. He's going to keep going that way. So you've got these two issues that are really dogging them. And I do think the temperament issue, we didn't see today in his speech. I thought his speech was very good. I thought he was very measured. But his temperament issue, I think, is the thing that's preventing him from being up to about 52 to 54%. Because when you look at all the underlying issues behind Biden, approval, age, policy, he's losing.
Yeah, well, I will say one thing President Trump could, just again, according to what you're saying, the temperament, something that could be changed here. Kind of saw that in the speech, Biden's age, his cognitive ability, something that's not going anywhere. It's sure. Here to stay. So
yes.
Great points, though. Keith Naughton, appreciate you coming on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, coming up, a night of revenge in Texas. We're going to talk about this after the break. Stick with us here on our special coverage of Super Tuesday. Okay, welcome back. Let's head over to our very own Tom Basile with some more details on the polls. We know California just shut things down not too long ago. Already, Trump declared the victor here. Tom, what can you tell us?
That's right. Trump winning the biggest prize of the night, the state of California, 169 delegates up for grabs there. And again, it's a jungle primary, so you're going to have the top. So the top two in these various races that we're going to be talking about are the ones that are going to make it on to November. But let's talk about Steve Garvey. Looks like he's going to finish in the top two. Numbers are still coming in there against Adam Schiff. That's big for Republicans to be able to even just be competing in California like that. David Valadao in California, Congressional District number 22, is also up. That's a seat that Joe Biden won by 13 points. So if Valadao survives in this primary, that's a seat that that could stay in Republican hands. If not, it then becomes a toss-up. We're also keeping an eye on California District number 45, which is Michelle Steele's district. That's also a district where you've got a Democrat majority there, and that's a seat the Democrats could flip. What's driving the voters to the polls in the state of California? The economy, 27%, 14% on immigration. Affordable housing is also kind of related to the economy there, and crime, 11%. You'd think that that would be a little bit higher, but none of these actually at this point accrue a benefit to Democrats right now. Obviously, a big issue there in California is just the number, sheer number of Republicans and right-leaning individuals who have moved out of the state since Gavin Newsom became governor. All right, now let's go back east because we've been talking about how Republicans could pick up some districts in North Carolina. If we go over to the state of North Carolina now, and we talk about what's happening over in North Carolina 1. Both Lori Buckhout and Sandy Smith are, it looks like Buckhout has pulled that out. She will have an opportunity to go up against Don Davis, who is a freshman member of the Democratic Party. He could actually end up losing. This would be a pickup. In Alabama 1, you've got two Republican members of Congress because of redistricting facing off with each other. It looks like Barry Moore is going to win that. At this point, that's a safe Republican seat, but important there, you're going to have a little bit of a shakeup there in that that delegation there. And then Colin Allred, the former NFL linebacker, looks like he is going to not only win in Texas but avoid a runoff. He will be then challenging Texas Senator Ted Cruz in November. And before I forget, Jason Palmer has won American Samoa. I'm not entirely sure who Jason Palmer is, but he has beaten Joe Biden in American Samoa. I figured you guys would like to know that.
We do.
All right. Tom Vasily, thank you so much for breaking that down for us. Mercy, I want to get your reaction here, because as we dig into these races, the House, the Senate, obviously the general election, there is some change coming on the horizon Friday, March 8th. Ron McDaniel is going to be stepping down.
That's right.
Head of the RNC. How does that change things as we look ahead?
Well, look, I think that Donald Trump made his message known that he wanted a change at the RNC. I think that Ron McDaniel spent so much time focusing on these primary debates that were completely fruitless and useless. And so moving in, Michael Whatley, who is a very experienced attorney, has done a lot of work in North Carolina. And then we have Laura Trump as the co-chair. She's an excellent fundraiser, an excellent communicator, because the key is they got to bring donors back to the RNC,
right?
Because they feel that there's been a lot of mismanagement when it comes to the financial situation. So I think the goal there will be the RNC has to focus on investing in these races where you are in these swing states to make sure that you're able to win the Senate seats that need to be won, as well as the presidency. That's critical, and it's going to take a lot of not only chasing the vote, but also the election issues, legal issues that they're going to experience.
Right. Let's talk more about the RNC. We know Nikki Haley, she signed a pledge, you know, with the RNC that she would support the presumptive GOP nominee when it happened. She's kind of backtracked on that. Hasn't totally done it, but kind of. Do you think if she were to come out now, and I'm not saying she's going to, but if she did and said, I'm put my hat in the ring for former President Trump. Does that help him?
Look, if she wants to salvage the little bit that she has left of her political career, she needs to come out and support Donald Trump full force. And I think she did try to spin her way out of responding to that question, but the right thing for her to do, if she wants to stay in the Republican Party, is support Donald Trump and say we need to forge ahead together, we have to unify, we have to beat the Marxists, we have to beat the far left, hence we have to beat Joe Biden.
Now there are some projections out there that we're going to see the House flip to Democrats, Republicans pick up the Senate. Do you think perhaps there's a better chance with the change in leadership at the RNC? And
I think there will be an aggressive push to invest in these swing states, in swing districts for the House. I think the Senate map looks very favorable for the Republicans. So, you know, it's going to be interesting. But remember, when it's a presidential year, if President Trump is doing well in these swing states that matter, that should bring along the House candidates, should bring along the Senate candidates as well.
After today, and Jason Miller with the Trump campaign, he was on one of our shows earlier saying, need not worry about raising campaign funds here. Now that we're getting beyond Super Tuesday here, we've seen the turnout. Do you think that big haul that the Republicans are looking for is going to come? Because we know Joe Biden has built one heck of a war chest.
Yeah, remember, Republicans get outspent many of times at 1-10, 1-7. The outside money that's coming in, whether it's the George Soros money, the Mark Zuckerberg money, look, it's significant. And Republicans are at a disadvantage when it comes to raising money. So they got to be efficient on how they're going to spend it. And it's not going to work just spending money on a bunch of bus tours. It's going to have to be strategic in the critical districts that we that
ground
need to
game,
be
won. Huh?
Ground game is critical as well.
All right, Mercedes Schlapp, thank you. Stay with us, of course.
Okay, coming up, how close to tonight's victories bring former President Trump to officially clinching the Republican nomination again? We're going to break down those numbers next on our special coverage on Super Tuesday.
All right, welcome back, everyone, to our special Super Tuesday coverage. Let's talk about the numbers. Donald Trump has now secured 942 delegates. That leaves him just 273 short of the 1,215 needed to win the Republican nomination. So what comes next? Well, the next big round of primaries are a week away on March 12th. So the big question, will Trump be able to wrap up the nomination by then? We are back with senior political analyst Rick Santorum and former White House advisor Mercedes Schlapp. Senator, I think a lot of people are wondering, when can we just move forward? Trump versus Biden, watch Nikki Haley step aside. Do you think that comes tonight, or are we waiting another week or perhaps longer?
I just bring you back to other election cycles. The one I'm most familiar with is when I ran in 2012. I dropped out of the race in April, but Ron Paul and Newt Gingrich stayed in the race for weeks. And in fact, Ron Paul stayed in until the convention. But the race was over, and it just stopped. People just stopped covering it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where we are. There, you know, once you reach the point where it is obvious who's going to win the nomination, and it's going to, whether it's next week or the week after, you just move on. And I know there will be some in the media who will try to keep this going, but it's not unusual for a candidate to just sort of stick around. Why do they stick around? Well, in Ron Paul's case, he had a bunch of hardcore donors who were grassroots donors, and he was fighting for his principles, and he just sort of stayed around. Newt just stayed around because Newt just wanted to stay around. He liked giving speeches, and he had enough money to do it.
Didn't he want to colonize the moon?
Newt had lots of great ideas.
Exactly.
But anyway, so Nikki may just stick around. That doesn't necessarily mean you have to pay any attention to her because she's not really contesting the election at this point.
We're not hearing from her tonight. We know that.
Yep, so. And Trump did not mention her in his speech as well. She has no planned campaign stops on the docket. I report on that every Monday here. She's got nothing past today here. Doesn't the RNC, though, Mercedes, got a plan? They got a plan for the future, plan for that ground game we were just talking about.
Right.
And how does having the second person in here maybe prohibit that?
Well, Ronna McDaniel already had mentioned that Haley should have dropped out, but she didn't. They really don't have that power to tell a candidate to drop out. Do you want to?
But once they have the number of delegates, 50% locked up, then they can begin the transition. So you're talking about a week or two
but
at the most.
Let's talk about it.
It starts working.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I want to bring up that Nikki Haley raised $1 million just in these few days of March. She raised about $12 million in February. If the money continues, she has the money to spend, she might go ahead and spend it. Look,
Joe Biden is the one that's so excited that Nikki Haley remains in the race because she gets to be the thorn in Donald Trump's side. And there's going to be a trial in the next few weeks with Donald Trump showing up to the trial. And then she's going to try to again say, I know I've lost almost every single state except for Vermont and the District of Columbia. But, you know, look, he's got a lot of legal problems. Why continue in that direction? So she might be betting for him to end up in the situation where he is convicted. What does that mean? But I think that the delegates would not choose Nikki Haley as number two. They would pick a Rick Santorum over Nikki Haley in the race.
We're going.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm kidding, Rick.
I don't know if that's possible.
So much love in this room tonight. My goodness.
No, he kind of liked it. He kind of liked it.
Real quick, guys. So we're looking ahead, obviously, right? March 12th, more primaries. We've got Georgia, Hawaii, Mississippi, Washington. The Trump campaign has signaled that March 12th is a target date to lock up the nomination. Rick, you think that's how
I don't see any of those states being any different than the 15 other states that have voted. I mean, you look at Massachusetts and Maine, if you can put those up on the board. I mean, those are two states that, again, New England states near New Hampshire where Nikki did well, near Vermont, but the races weren't even close. I mean, it was 60-40, I think, in Massachusetts and even more in Maine. So if she can't do well there, in states that aren't really on the nose for her, like a Vermont is, she's not going to do well in Washington State. I almost won Washington State in 2012. Why? Because if you're a Republican in Washington State, you're probably a conservative. In fact, if you think about it, you go outside the Cascades and the other side and into eastern Washington, it's actually a fairly conservative area. You elect Republican congressmen there. So where the Republicans are, they're generally conservative. Trump will do very well there.
Right. Rick, let me ask you this. It's hard, right, to run for president, correct?
I would vouch for that. Yes, it is.
So Nikki Haley has given this her best shot, without question here. She's hung in all this way.
And she's exceeded every expectation.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You have to give somebody credit for that. It takes a lot of courage to do that.
Exceeded expectations?
Yeah, she has.
Oh,
I don't think anyone would have suggested that she would have been.
How low was the bar?
Well, I know, exactly.
Look, as someone who you know, was, when I
Rick,
dropped out, was the number two.
Like a caucus.
I understand that, but it's hard to get to that point where you look, Mitt Romney was the dominant player in 16. You had George Bush in 2000. You had dominant players going into this. Trump was the dominant player.
Yeah,
and the fact that she finished second is something to take a bow for.
The point I was getting at, though.
And she should be able to leave with that as something to be proud of.
And leaving sooner rather than later is a great idea for Nikki Haley. Either, it is time for her to drop out.
That was where I was trying to get to this here.
Too big right now,
either
Ray.
Either way, she's out of the race
in a
week.
This country is in shambles. I'm telling you, Americans do not feel safe. We are in the brink of going into even more, greater conflicts across the globe.
Can I ask you a question?
And this is why it is so important for Republicans to come together.
I agree with all that.
To defeat the Marxists and to defeat Joe Biden. That's what we got to do.
Tonight,
it is the most critical moment.
Final thought.
Was tonight a bad night for Donald Trump?
It was an excellent night for Donald
Trump.
Okay,
it would not have been there would have been no reporting tonight had Nikki Haley not been in the race. You can make the argument the wipeout that Donald Trump did tonight actually helped him.
The waste of money that Nikki Haley, spent in terms of this ridiculous campaign where she could only
many could argue
I didn't mean to open up this wound here, but I mean,
that's why we have to be
robust
to
debate.
To people.
I get both points, though. I certainly do here.
Oh, Bob.
We want to keep it moving.
Agree to disagree. A very spirited conversation here, Mercedes and Rick. Thank you both.
You bet.
All right, straight ahead. The elephant in the room, questions surrounding Biden's age and his mental acuity. Democrats have recently been saying the quiet part out loud. So will they ever ditch Joe Biden? We'll discuss that and a lot more up next. Welcome back, everyone, to our Super Tuesday coverage. Well, Trump and Nikki Haley may have everybody's attention tonight, but Biden's ability to serve out another term is definitely the elephant in the room.
Certainly is. Even the New York Times, they cannot ignore it, Jen. Their last poll found that a majority of his 2020 voters think he's too old to be effective as president. And for more on this, we're going to bring in our panel. to discuss. We're going to keep it nice and civil.
Oh, my, Bob.
Huh?
It's 11:30 at night.
That's what I'm saying. It's too late.
Civil, out the door, civility. Let's
people need to see some energy up here.
I kind of agree.
Okay. Well,
I start getting punchy around 11:30 at night, so this is good.
Keep
this
the punches going, then.
Exactly.
Too old to be effective?
Too old. Yes, he's too old. He should retire, as the President Trump says. Who wants to see Joe Biden in a swimsuit? Give me a break. I don't understand how Jill Biden just doesn't take her husband and be like, honey, it's time to just go to our really expensive home in Rehoboth Beach.
It is, too.
Probably bought by the Chinese at this point, and just get out of politics. But there is no desire for that to happen, I don't think, within that Biden family to make sure that Joe Biden steps away.
And let's just remember, Donald Trump, 77. Some are now trying, in the media, are trying to pin that Trump is now not as sharp as he once
was. Right, he confuses Melania with Mercedes, according to the fake news.
Alyssa Farah, former communications officer of the White House, no friend of Trump's, but she also came out recently. So, he's not the same that he was in 16 and 20.
Right.
But, you know, I think, Senator, you know, it's not so much about the age, it's about where you are at that age. You look at Donald Trump at 77. You know, you can't argue that man is extremely sharp, works around the clock,
2 hours
goes nonstop,
flies around
the teleprompter, versus Joe Biden, who obviously many have expressed concern about his.
Are you going to believe the media, or are you going to believe your lying eyes? That's the reality is people see Joe Biden for what he is, and they see Donald Trump for what he is. You may not like Donald Trump, but he certainly is a vigorous guy. He's certainly sharp. He's certainly on top of things, and Joe Biden simply isn't. And you at that age, you don't get better. This is not something. Well, he's going to rally and somehow his faculties are going to improve. He's not, and that's the problem that the Democrats see. And they thought they could hide it because they effectively did in 2020. They're not effectively hiding it. And I think what you're going to see is Joe Biden make a push here. I think what you're going to see from Biden is a pugnacious guy. He's a narcissist, but he's very pugnacious. And I think what you're going to see from Biden is him starting to go really hard on the attack against Donald Trump. Mm. That's the strategy, is to try to get Trump off this mode he was tonight, which was calm, presidential, and get him to the street fight. And Biden can sit there and throw punches and shots at Trump with the hope that Trump gets off his game and makes it personal. If it's a food fight between Trump and Biden on just personality, that's a winner for Biden. It's not for Trump.
So real quick, guys, so interesting moment this week with Kamala Harris coming out, calling for a ceasefire in Gaza, 6-week ceasefire. We haven't heard that kind of language come from Joe Biden himself, kind of getting ahead of the president there. Almost makes me wonder if she's now trying to position herself as that authority figure to take.
Well, it's interesting because she did go to the Munich conference where she met with several foreign leaders. And, you know, the reality is the Democrats don't even want Kamala Harris. So there's when you're talking about a crisis within the Democrat Party, you have a very unpopular president and you have an extremely unpopular vice president. So what are they left with? They can't go with Michelle Obama because now she's not running. Gavin Newsom has made a mess in California. It's getting too late for the Democrats to make that quick change, and they can't just bypass Kamala Harris. It's not going to happen. Identity politics is the most important factor for Democrats.
It's so true. Like, when people discuss who might the fill-in be for Joe Biden, they never say Kamala Harris.
Never.
They never say it here. But I want to go back to the cognitive ability for Biden here and the transitioning to votes here. We talk about this a lot. Do voters actually switch the vote? Do they stay home because of this? He's winning big in his own race, you know, for the nomination again for the Democrats here.
Very low turnout. I mean,
is that what it's going to be?
Well, you're seeing it. You're seeing very low turnout among Democrats. Now, you can say, well, there's no real competition. There's no real reason to turn out. Go back, you know, 4 years ago, and you saw huge turnout among Republicans for Donald Trump because they were for Donald Trump. They wanted to show their support for Donald Trump. They wanted to project an image of strength. The Democrats are not doing that. They're not projecting a lot of enthusiasm behind Joe. If they love Joe Biden, you'd go out and vote. They don't.
Right.
They don't like Trump. I mean, it's clear Democrats don't like Trump, and they're going to come out on Election Day. But the question is, can he get more than his base? And right now, it's not looking good for Joe Biden.
All right, Mercedes and Rick, thank you. We've got Tom Vasile over at the board. You got another update for us, huh, Tom?
We have an update on that hotly contested Senate race in the state of California. If we could throw that up there, that would be great. Adam Schiff is going to advance to the lightning round in November. They have called it that he will be one of the top two, but a Dodger is making his move. And I'm a Yankee fan, so it kind of hurts me to say that. But Steve Garvey looks like he is on his way to being the other candidate who's going to square off against Schiff. And again, it's California, so the top two vote getters in the primary, even if they were two Republicans or two Democrats, are the ones who are going to advance into the general election. So Steve Garvey, looks like he is going to actually be squaring off against Adam Schiff. This is going to be a race to watch. And because Adam Schiff, kind of felt like he was going to be able to just cruise into this seat, he is going to benefit from Katie Porter and other Democrats dropping out of the race. But a lot of folks want to try to make this a race, even though California's lost so many Republicans and center-right voters over the last couple of years. But looks like Steve Garvey is going to make it to November.
All right. Exciting news there, Tom Vasile. Thank you so much. Let's make a note. One polls that did close were Utah at 11 p.m., still yet to be called for the GOP race there. So we'll bring that news to you as we get it. In the meantime, let's head over to Austin, Texas, where Mike Carter is tonight. Mike, what's the latest?
Hey, guys. Good evening. Well, if Nikki Haley was ever going to have a chance here in Texas, she was going to need to win big in the cities like Austin. And this is Travis County. It's the fifth most populous county in the state of Texas. And Nikki Haley, she didn't do well here. She lost by more than 20 points to Donald Trump. This is a very Democrat-friendly county. It hasn't voted Republican in all but five presidential elections since 1932. So this was the kind of county that Nikki Haley was going to need to win in tonight. And also Harris County, where Houston is. She's losing by almost 50 points in the county that the city of Houston lives in. So, you know, you think about these counties, was there ever a path for a victory for Nikki Haley in a place like Texas? She was going to need to capitalize on those Democrat voters, that this is an open primary here in Texas. So those Democrat voters here in blue cities like Austin, like Houston, the Dallas metro area, they could have, if they wanted to, voted in the Republican primary. We are seeing numbers come in tonight that just never materialized for Nikki Haley. All of these blue cities, these blue areas of Texas, even they went to Donald Trump. Just shows you Donald Trump looking like he's going to win by 60-plus points here in Texas.
Big win, Texas-size win there for Trump. Thank you, Mike Carter. Appreciate it in Austin. All right, folks, coming up, the economy has been a top issue on voters' minds for a long time, but immigration now topping most Americans' concerns. We'll talk about the impact that the issues have had when we look ahead to November's general election. Stay with us.
Okay, welcome back. With Donald Trump inching closer to locking up the Republican nomination, the focus will soon turn to the general election and the issues that will drive Americans to vote in November. Mercedes Schlapp is back with us, along with our political analyst, Mark Halper. And Mark, welcome to the conversation.
Good to be here. Surprised to find you guys still around, but that's great.
We're still awake.
Absolutely. The biggest issues, immigration, obviously, I think it's turned into really the biggest issue here. How does Trump convince the voters here? How does Biden make his case for it going forward?
Well, no coincidence that President Trump led his speech tonight talking about immigration. This is an issue that he has a fingertip feel for. And tonight on MSNBC, the hosts were making fun of Virginia voters saying immigration was important to them. They joked about sharing a border with West Virginia. The Democratic Party's denial on this issue as an emotional issue, as a policy issue, and as an issue that Joe Biden has inexplicably not done anything about is hurting them, and it's hurting them across the board, and the clock's ticking. We heard a couple weeks ago Joe Biden was going to have executive orders on immigration. I've not seen them yet.
No.
And their problem is the more he does on immigration, the more he loses his base. And right now he's got a base problem as much as anything else.
And, you know, hearing that, Mark, about what they were saying on another network, and Mercy, I think that's got to be so upsetting to a lot of Americans, especially in the wake of what happened to Laken Riley, the college student in Georgia, murdered allegedly by an illegal alien in this country during the Biden administration. This is a big issue, and people are feeling this across the country. I know you've spent a lot of time down at the border.
Yes.
You focus on the human trafficking aspect of it, the children, women and children that are being impacted by this. Talk to us about what you've seen.
Women and children, towns that are being impacted by this, where you have drug cartels literally taking over towns in places like Arizona, where there are rape trees, where literally women who are crossing the border are raped by these drug cartel members, and it's like a trophy, and it's disgusting. And the mere fact is that the American people are waking up not only to the crimes that are happening to everyday innocent Americans, but that these illegal aliens have come into this country. There's many, some of them are gang members from Venezuela that are literally easily coming through the border, committing these crimes, and they should have never been here. They should have been deported because they had past criminal records. And I think the American people have had it. And we know that with President Trump, there was coordination with Mexico, there were coordinations with the Triangle countries. We saw the border under control, completely opposite what we're seeing with Joe Biden. Back to Mark's point, you have the Congressional Hispanic Caucus, their Democrat members, saying don't change the asylum rules. They want to see more of an open border. So Biden is having friction with a lot of his own base, like these Hispanic leaders, not necessarily where the Hispanic voters are on
right,
this issue.
Right. And as Mark mentioned, Trump began his speech tonight with immigration. Let's take a listen to part of that.
There's never been anything like what's happening to our country. Today it was announced that 325,000 people were flown in from parts unknown. Migrants were flown in airplane, not going through borders, not going through that great Texas barrier that I was with the governor of Texas, Greg Abbott, the other day, and we were looking at the job they're doing. But in the meantime, they're pouring into California and they're pouring into Arizona because those governors aren't doing anything. They're doing nothing.
It's by design, Mark. No question.
Democrats talk a lot about the emotion of the issue of abortion, and there's no doubt that the Republicans are going to have to figure it out. Mercedes and others talked about that earlier, and Donald Trump is probably a more pro-choice by inclination than Joe Biden is, so he's got a fingertip feel for that. Immigration is an emotional issue, too, for so many Americans, and the Democrats don't seem yet to understand that, not just from a policy point of view, but from a human point of view. This isn't, people aren't passionate about this because they're wonky and they're reading the immigration laws. They see the effect it's having in their communities across the country.
Well, what about the fact of the financial ramifications of all this? We've heard Mayor Adams right here in New York City say, in a couple of years, we're going to go bankrupt over this problem. But it seems so weird to me that it continues to happen. If cities are going to go bankrupt, why doesn't Biden do something about it here? This makes no sense.
Well, and the Biden administration, I think they just want to, they want to see if the problem can go away. And I think for the Democrat mayors to basically not get a response from the White House, where it's constant pushback from the federal government, I think it's very telling. Because they in these cities, this has become an emergency for these cities and how they're going to deal with this problem with migrants. The problem is that the Biden administration really does not have a strategic plan. They're pushing it onto Congress, where you know Congress is not going to be able to get the job done. Executive orders is exactly what he needs to do. Okay. The President Biden needs to do.
Sorry to interrupt you, Mercy. We got to get to Tom over here at the board. Tom, you have some updates for us.
Yeah, you know, as we're getting ready to wrap, so I wanted to kind of give you a sense of where we ended up as we're taking a look at all of these states. And you know, we spent a lot of time talking about Nikki Haley tonight, but I think that it's we're probably at a transition point at this point where. We stop talking about Nikki Haley, and then for the Trump folks start talking about Nikki Haley's voters. And as we make our way across the country, and we see where actually the the former governor has ended up. You know, generally about one in four voters on average kind of went for Haley. And so now, as you transition into the next phase of the campaign, who are those people? And well, it'll be interesting to see how Trump says, all right, well, who are those voters and how do you start pulling those voters into back into the fold as the Haley campaign starts to basically head out into the sunset here as we as this primary election turns into what is going to end up being one of the longest general elections in American political history, and as Donald Trump takes another step closer to doing something that's only been done once before in American history, served two non-consecutive terms. So we'll see.
Indeed, we will. Tom DeSilly, thank you so much.
Appreciate it, Tom.
Hey, coming up, folks, millions of Americans voted tonight in tonight's primaries. Up next, we'll take a final look at the results with our panel. Stay with us. Welcome back, everybody, to our special Super Tuesday coverage. Glad to have our panel here, Mark Helper and Mercedes Schlapp. Big night for Donald Trump. Had to laugh, though. I saw Axios headline come through that Nikki Haley avoids a Trump sweep on Super Tuesday, Mark. Interesting way of looking at that. I think a lot of people might say Trump dominated Super Tuesday. Your final thoughts?
As goes Vermont, does not go the Republican Party. They were by themselves, and Nikki Haley's not dropping out tonight. She put out a statement saying the party still needs to unify, but I agree with Mercedes. I think we could be 24 hours away from her reading the handwriting written in giant red letters on the wall.
Certainly could happen. What about Trump's demeanor in that speech? Didn't mention Nikki Haley. Seemed like business.
Yeah, I think Donald Trump has basically said that the people have spoken. And the way to succeed now is going to be to unify the party, moving on to fighting Joe Biden, making that contrast. I think that's where we're headed. I think for Nikki Haley, it's time for her to help unite the Republican Party and basically push back against Joe Biden's.
Could certainly happen, right?
Yep.
Well, mend the wounds, the campaign trail.
You know, he made up with Ron DeSantis for that. He gave up to sanctimonious. I think he can give up bird brain.
Quickly, guys.
I think we're there.
State of the Union Thursday, big predictions. Biden come out with anything that'll be a game changer to contrast these wins for Trump today?
I think if he comes in and does cartwheels, it's not going to do much except give him a little bit of a start.
Cartwheels, you're giving me
I think
President Trump gave his State of the Union address today. He defined where we are in America and what needs to be changed. I think Joe Biden, I don't know how he's going to make his case. And one thing you're going to know is that Speaker Mike Johnson will not be ripping that State of the Union address because he is a man of great respect, unlike former Speaker Nancy Pelosi.
Wasn't that something when that happened?
The rip heard around the world.
It was outrageous.
Right. Yep. My, how the country has changed since then.
Oh, yes,
here we are,
it has.
Looking at a repeat of 2020.
Sounds shaping up to be. What a night. What a night for the country. Progressing through, learning more and more each day on who our nominees will be. We'll see what happens with Nikki Haley tomorrow. Mercedes Schlapp, thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful for you having you tonight. Mark Halperin, just as well, sir. And thank you to everyone at home for staying with us during our Super Tuesday primary election coverage right here on Newsmax. That does it for us tonight. I'm Bob Brooks.
And I'm Jen Pellegrino. Have a great night, everybody. Thanks for sticking with us.